I'm freaking out, man.
You can't handle the truth. You can't handle the truth.
What do all men in power want? More power.
My name is Gianluca Zanna. I was an Italian by birth, and I became an American by choice. Our lives and freedoms are in danger.
This is not a dream.
If you're listening to this broadcast, you are the resistance.
All systems go.
Welcome to Love, Guns, and Freedom. Here we go, guys and girls. Welcome to another Sunday show. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with Luca Zanna on KTOX 1340 AM and on United States to the FM Network. By the way, last Sunday was really a great experience. Normally, you know, I do not do broadcasting live, but it was a long time I went to the station. And I really enjoy, you know, a lot of calls and different feeling. Because, you know, normally I record from my Arizona locations, and I never go to the station crossing the river on the other side. And but when I'm live, I tell you, it is kind of fun. And more important, I like to interact directly with you. That was really great. I appreciate it. At the same time, it breaks my heart to think how much, really, everything changes when I cross the river. I think I told you last Sunday, I had to go back to my office because I realized 5 miles down the road that I forgot 2 empty magazines for my AR-15 in the back of my truck. And normally you say, what is that? Just a regular piece of metal. Not even a bullet inside. Not even a round. Excuse me. Not a bullet. Ammunition. Guess what? That would be enough for a felony if they pull me over. Think about that. And just the feelings. You know, the first time I crossed that border, the first sign was, you know, lock up your seatbelt. It's the law. I mean, what the heck? I mean, feeling like I was really coming almost to Italy. Going to Italy. That was scary. Anyway, now I'm back here. And I appreciate it, by the way. I appreciate all your calls, support. And even every time, you know, somebody wants to put out a critic out and is a constructive and positive critic, I do appreciate it. As I said, this is for me a challenge. It's a journey. I mean, the fact that I'm trying to be behind the microphone and, you know, my English even is supposed to be, and it is my first language. That's all I speak. But, you know, unfortunately, I wasn't born here. And I didn't go to schools, not because you learn much in the school, especially the public schools, but still. My English still sucks, pretty hard to believe, but that's the way it is. So I'm trying my best. But regardless, the topics I bring you here on this show, they're nothing but entertaining. I even hate to call this a show. This is not a showcase, a show entertaining time. This is real matters. They're matters that really, I tell you, they touch my heart. They also make me realize how much humanity is in danger. Comes down to America, of course, but to all over the world. This global government is a global tyranny that is going to touch all of us. And I tell you, more I learn, more I go down to the rabbit hole. I'm learning things that sometimes that I cannot even sleep at night. You know, a few months ago, at this point, more than 1 year ago, I had this gentleman that I met at the Bundy's standoff or whatever, a ranch. His name is, you already know the name, Ken Rhodes, okay? And he started to talk to me about targeted individuals. And as I said, you know, I have an open mind to everybody, for everything. Because I learned the first thing you want to know that you don't know. You don't know everything. How can you know everything? It's impossible. Like when it comes down to the government, I tell you, I have a very open mind. Because I know history and I know governments in general around the world that are the biggest criminals in history. That's it. I mean, nobody killed more people than government. That's a fact. So I'm a very open mind, especially after I learned, of course, 9/11, Oklahoma City, and different other things that, unfortunately, we've been lied to. Yes, when somebody brings me things like information about other potential or allegations of crimes perpetrated by part of the government, I have an open mind. And more important, I do my researches. So at this point, it is not the first interview that I have. I've been bringing you a very important guest that they are pretty much, I say always alleging, because, you know, I'm here behind the microphone, but I go through the records. In my opinion, if I bring them here, means that they have a very good, let's say, case to say that they have that problem. And the problem I'm talking here is targeted individuals. So right now, today, I have a lady. I've been studying and following her for a while. And the more I learn about her, more I say, wow, if half the things she's saying are true, this is really something that we need to understand and learn. Because what they're doing to her, what they've done to her, they can do to every one of us. So I really believe, at least I ask you one thing, have an open mind to listen and then do your own researches. That's all I'm saying. Because I understand it's tough to believe. But there's a point that once I learn at least part of the truth, because, you know, as I said, I will never know all the truth, it's my duty to share it with you. I cannot just keep it for myself. Even sometimes it's tough. I tell you, after I did the interview with Karen Stewart, former NSA whistleblower, I had him on my show, and I should have it pretty soon again, by the way. I tell you, I had the very strange things happen to me, and I will talk now more with the guest. And then also, I tell you, every time I do this type of interviews, like, for example, I had with William Binney, the former NSA whistleblower, one of the, probably before even Snowden. And then, of course, with Mr. Stewart and other people like her. My computer is going crazy just a few minutes before I start the interview. And right now, the same story, it happened. Hopefully, it's going to stop with my guest, Mrs., Carla Grady. Carla, are you there?
Yes, Luca. Hi. Thank you for having me.
Very good,
such
Carla.
Such an honor.
Oh, thank you. My honor. And please, just give us briefly, tell us where you're calling from and tell us about a little bit who you are.
Yes, my name is Carla Grady, and I'm residing in Bakersfield, California. I've been a targeted individual since 1994 and pretty much had my whole life turned upside down because of this crime. And
let's explain. Carla, can you explain exactly? Because, you know, out of the blue, you know, 1994, whenever you were, how did you find out that you were targeted individuals? I mean, individual, there are no books, you know, that it's not like you can say, find it in the yellow pages. Oh, yes, I'm a target individual. What exactly was happening to you? And how did you find out that that's what really happened to you?
In 1992, I dated a man whose sole purpose was to attract me for human trafficking. And I was very young at the time. I was probably, I think, 23. And he's a very good-looking man. He said all the right things and did all the right things, you know. And he portrayed to me that he wanted to be my husband.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a wonderful, charming man. Everybody in the community loved him. But he had a hidden agenda of attracting women for human trafficking.
Wow.
And I did not know that he lived a double life, that he was doing, his family was mafia, and he was into some very illegal things. On my side, he was very charming, very wonderful. Everybody liked him. He was very charismatic, and I fell in love with him. I was just in love with him, you know. And anyway, we were together for quite a while, and I started seeing some red flags. And this is the father of my son.
Wow.
I had just gone through a divorce, and, you know, I was a single woman, and I was very vulnerable, and I had a daughter by my first husband. My first husband was a wonderful man. He was a wonderful Christian, but it just didn't work. And my daughter would be my first child. My second child was born in 1994 by this man. And soon after my son was born, he started acting really strange, being very secretive, doing things to upset me and make me feel afraid of, you know, being with him. And I started seeing a lot of women come around, you know, mm-hmm. and I soon discovered that they were all prostitutes. And basically, he was running human trafficking. And I began to see red flags, and so I started snooping around, and I found these magazines. They're called snuff magazines. Now, I don't know if you've ever heard of snuff magazines, but they're very evil. They actually murder women while having sex with them and photograph it.
Oh my God! I mean, talking about nothing simulated. It is real murdering.
Yes, and he and other men were in these magazines.
Oh my God!
And being photographed with dead women, and so.
Question.
Anyway,
did they wear any mask? So, I mean, did they go into this magazine without mask like that? I mean, just with their face exposed?
Sometimes, yes. You would see them in the shadow, the silhouette. You would see them in the silhouette, and I recognized the father of my son very well because I had been with him for so long. I recognized him as being a participant in this magazine.
Wow. Oh, my God. This is, and unfortunately, what you're saying, just to let you know, I mean, there has been also movies out there that have been doing this, but this is not about a movie. This is real. There is a human trafficking. It's been exposed. I mean, there are corporations out there that have been also investigated, found even, let's say, guilty, and it's still nothing really happened. There are big powers out there. Because the problem is, wherever there is a traffic, it means there are customers, there is a demand. And normally the people who can afford this type of vicious crimes and very sick crimes, they are people that they are in powers. I mean, people that have a lot of money, okay? I mean, you know, these are like, you need to have like almost a custom movie that is not just about making a little porn movie. This is about killing an innocent person, or torturing him, or torturing her, and this is something so criminal. And as you said, they need the actress, they need the actors. And normally what they do, nobody's volunteers for this type of movies, okay? They need to really say human trafficking is part of how they find these poor victims.
Yes, he sought out women who came from broken homes, who had no family support, mm-hmm. People who wouldn't be missed in the community. I was passed around from foster home. So it was easy for him to see that I was vulnerable, you know, and when he found out I got a divorce, of course he thought, oh wow, this is a great opportunity. But anyway, when I found these magazines, I reported him, not knowing his background, mm-hmm. not knowing where he came from, and I got a restraining order against him, and I never saw him again. But I reported him to the FBI, and I turned him in, and he basically told me that he did this to me, and he said I was microchipped. And back in the day, I just laughed at him. I said, you're crazy, you know, who would microchip me, you know? Mm-hmm. Well, I had stomach cancer, and they opened up my stomach, and he told me the microchip was in my stomach.
Wow.
And he told me that I had been microchipped in several places, and he says, your life is ruined. Your life will be turned upside down. Everybody will hate you. And he said, even your own family will turn against you. He said, good luck getting out. And I just laughed, and I thought he was crazy. And he says, yeah, you bet. He told me I was microchipped. And I just laughed at him. I said, you're nuts, you know. And I couldn't, you know, I couldn't take anything he said seriously. So anyway, I moved to another city. I got a restraining order against him. A church helped me get away from him, and I was able to hide from him for quite a while. Nothing actually happened up until probably, I would say, about maybe 5 years, 4 or 5 years, maybe not even that, maybe 3 or 4 years. My recollection is kind of shady, but I noticed that people were starting to take pictures of me and starting to point at me and whisper, and I noticed that my character was being defamed. You know, like people would look at me weird, and it was like I was famous for something that I, you know, that I had no idea, you know. At first I thought, well, maybe they're just looking at me, you know. You know, I don't know what's going on. And then I started getting harassment from biker gangs, real life bikers, you know, and different gangs. And I was like, what the heck? I mean, they would ride up on me and throw things at me and spit on me and do horrible things and spray me with chemicals that would break me out in rashes. And, I mean, they would just do horrific things. And I thought, what the heck is going on?
Now, can I ask you something? One second, Holly.
Yes.
Because, you know, what you're saying, I tell you something. I've been talking with several people the last few months, I think almost more than 1 year, similar cases to yours.
I
don't even know if...
I don't even know if...
What's going on now with the audio?
What's going on now with the audio?
Are you still there?
I'm here.
Are you still there?
Yes.
Do you hear the double echo?
Do you hear the double echo?
Yes.
Okay, I don't know. I think I need to call you again. Okay, stay there. I call you back because I cannot do this. By the way, this has never happened before. This is so funny. Okay, let me just call her back. I'm not going to go away. I'm sorry. You have no idea. When I was calling Mrs. Grady, Carla Grady, just like probably not 30 minutes ago, the moment that she told me I'm available, let's go recording, my computer was working great. I mean, not a problem, not a flinch, nothing. The moment that you say, yes, call me, bang, all three programs, it starts to all freeze. And Skype was acting out weird, almost was typing his own numbers. I mean, almost funny, if it wasn't so real. Anyway, now I'm calling again. I never had this sort of echo feedback. It's kind of out of place. Hey, let's try again. I don't care. I'm not going to go away. I'm here. Let's call Carla Grady. Carla?
Yes.
Okay, no problem. Just a little technical problem. We're here, okay? So I would say, what I've been noticing, and I wanted to this, probably you already know this, but I'm trying to share this with people that maybe they're just tuning in for the first time about this topic and say, what's going on? One thing I really think you have in common with many other people, that first of all, you're normally they like women. I don't say women only, but let's say women have a good big situation here going on. I don't know, because it could be the sexual part or the human trafficking part. Normally, women, they are the first raw material. But don't worry, because even guys, they are used for these situations. But women is a big chunk of the statistic I'm trying to learn here. Then number two, mostly they are beautiful women. By the way, you know, you look beautiful now. I can imagine how you were beautiful when you were in your 20s. So attractive women.
Mm-hmm.
And then I see also another important case. Mostly they come from, let's say, broken homes. I mean, talking about no families. I have other people that I've been also meeting from Europe. Okay, I don't want to go into details. I want to keep their privacy. But, for example, Northern Europe, I had a great lady that she's a very good-looking lady. And same story. She was somehow without parents, and she has to go through from foster home to from foster home. And similar story really to yours. There's always this handler, this some sort of a charming guy, that then you start to wake up, and you start to see things in the real way, and then after that, the harassment starts. And the point is, I'm still trying to figure it out why. I mean, why after, you know, you start to somehow wake up, you really, your life become a misery, a torture. Do they enjoy looking at you in this sort of a powerless situation? Or maybe also is part to study how a human brain, a human case, a human being, how much can bear of all this before jumps in the lake or commits suicide? I mean, what do you think? Why they're doing this? What is their goal? What is the angle?
Well, first of all, it's like a live game of chess, okay? They exhaust every single aspect of your life. And let me just say, they do have goals. They want you to either commit, you to have you commit suicide, they would kill you with electronic weapons. Due to a lot of targeted individuals suffer massive heart attacks and die that way, as well as suicide. And their other goal is to get you number one, you lose your job. You have no income. You have no source of money. They want you homeless. They want you diagnosed in front of a psychiatrist as being crazy. They try to get you diagnosed so that everybody thinks that you're just crazy. And when the cops come out, they just go ahead and lock you up, you know, and dismiss your claims. They just do everything to discredit you in every way, shape, or form. And let me tell you, when this first kicked off, my mother participated in this. My grandmother participated. My neighbors participated. Every single friend that I have is participating.
Wow.
And
I trust no one
in my circle anymore. It's not safe anymore.
I want to ask you something because, you know, I want to always have an open mind for both sides, okay? Because sometimes I really know that there are, of course, this going on. And I, according to the study that I've been doing, or at least about you, you know, you look like you got a really interesting case. Let's put it this way. But sometimes also, you know, there are also when you're in the state of mind, then you start to look at everybody could be a potential perpetrator, at least let's say an accomplice, okay? When it comes down to the family, you really think that maybe it's not just maybe in your mind now that you are in this state of mind to look also there, or you really have proofs? Because I always try to bring also proofs that maybe also your close family, they're part of this.
They have a way of identifying themselves. They're very bold with the identity process of being a perpetrator. Mm-hmm. They use a technique called gaslighting, where they psychologically harm you while being nice to you. That's like me walking, for example, that would be like me walking up to you, asking you for directions and putting my hand in my pocket and coming out like I'm going to pull a gun on you. These are the techniques that they do to make you question. They do things to make you question your own sanity. And when you confront them, they bold-faced lie to you. And say that you're crazy. They all have a script that they're trying to say is that you're crazy. You're losing it. What is wrong with you? You know. And when you start to question them, they get very hostile. And you're crazy. You need to get psychological help. That's what they all tell you. And so it doesn't even do you any good to confront them because they're sworn to secrecy. It's a secret, thing that they do. And really, they boldly identify themselves. And so there's really no question about who's doing what, you know. If your heart is telling you, your gut instincts are telling you that your environment is being jeopardized, it's usually for a good reason. Your instincts don't usually mislead you and guide you. And usually if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it mm-hmm. is a duck. No, you know what I'm saying?
No, I understand. I understand. I'm just
and
trying
they
to...
use the street theater. They use street theater. They follow me around with their bright lights on every day. And they leave their porch light. They signal. They use every single means of communication to speak to you and to speak to each other. They signal with... I mean, they use porch lights, they use Coke cans, they use trash cans, they sensitize you to certain things and they make a big smoke screen, and it's like they're telling you a story with all of these props. And if you ask them why are they doing that, they have a perfectly valid explanation. And if you try to confront them and say, why are you gang stalking me, or why are you doing this to me? And they just tell you you're crazy.
Let me ask you something. This is unfortunately is not just you. I've been talking with several people in the last few months, and I tell you, this is like a pattern. Seems very much the same over and over. Now I want to be also very fair. You know, I'm not saying that everybody who's having these experiences may be part of a project of target individuals. Sometimes there are also cases of, I'm not a doctor, I'm not trying to say anything about anybody, but you know, there are cases that you can also have your imagination going. I don't think it's your case, but I want to be fair, because sometimes, you know, I'll tell you something, you know, sometimes there is also a movement to discredit the real cases, okay? I mean, they create false situations, very much like almost laughable, okay? And so every time, you know, there is something moving out there, oh, I'm a target individual. Sometimes people just need some love, maybe need some attention, maybe need a friend. Okay, don't get me wrong. You know, there are some cases that, you know, just because your day is boring, don't start to become part of a group just because you think it's cool or it's hip. Because that's not the case. This is a serious matter. So I'm trying to always say, please.
These are people I identify them because they do things in a very, very systematic order. Mm-hmm. And this, I didn't actually get the voice to school until probably 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And it's been pretty violent with me. They've been pretty hands-on with me because I'm a very strong Christian woman. And I'm very strong-minded and very strong-hearted. And so they've been using physical means to break me down. People in my church actually gave me scopolamine and Viskin, and they tried to break me down physically.
Wow. What do you mean, break you down physically? Did they give you
Go ahead.
Excuse me, when you say break you down physically, did they try to put some sort of exorcism on you? They try to tie you up? Or what did they do exactly?
No, they put this in my food. I cleaned house for several people in my church, and they actually participated by giving me poisonous drugs. Okay, this is a tranquilizer used for horses.
Wow.
And it's used to maim you, okay? And it has attributes of Alzheimer's. It has attributes of forgetfulness. You black out. You can't walk. You're totally at the mercy of these people, okay?
Now, when you say, who's really behind, you know, we say they, okay? I have my opinion, but it's just my opinion. I understand also the programs
I
like that.
I truly believe that mine is mob-related, okay? Everybody has different reasons why they were put into the program. Mm-hmm. A lot of them are whistleblowers. Unfortunately, a lot of boyfriends do this to women, okay? A lot of husbands do this to women.
No, I understand. But to have, Carla, to have the technology and the organization, okay? Don't get me wrong. The mob, I really believe that at least in Italy, is controlled by the CIA. That's a fact, okay? So
right.
It's proven. And I think also here, I'm sure they have their own connection. So even the mob, even the biggest crime organization or criminal organization or organized organization, you know, this type of technology and science doesn't come out from some, you know, Sopranos family, okay? Comes from billions of dollars of research. And there is always some sort of a study behind that normally, you know, in organized crime, they want to make money, okay? They don't really enjoy just torturing people for the fun of it unless there is some money behind. I really believe that.
Exactly.
What is really behind here could be maybe, this is just my humble opinion, of course, and I don't know if I'm right. We never know.
It's human experimentation.
Exactly, because they can see, you know, in some, they have a case report, okay? They look at a part of humanity. Normally, as I said, I'm noticing
this is a government-funded program, I believe, and we're all human labs.
Exactly.
I mean, we're lab rats. We're guinea pigs for the government.
And this is my point.
But
you know,
somebody inducted us into this crime, right?
Yes. And people once say, no, government never would do that. Are you kidding me? All you have to do, go to Google and find out all the declassifieds. And that's only what we found out. Experimentation without the consent of the civilians that the U.S. government and many other governments, of course, but we're talking about now the U.S. government has done at least the last 50 years. And when it comes down to mind control, there is one very big that is being declassified, and it's called MK Ultra. Okay. And this is not even close to what we're talking here. This is like all technology. Now they have a new technology. They can say, start to manipulate your thoughts. At least they can start to put sounds in your mind from distances. They can use satellite to also use frequencies in directly to you to tune in with your brain and start to create emotions.
They are doing that to me.
You know? Yes. And why people say, why they're doing that? Okay, I'll give you now my short, very ignorant answer. Look what we are facing right now. Look, we have these elections, okay? And we have at least, let's say, 50% of the population. And I am not a Republican. I'm not a Trump supporter, okay? I'm talking, though, there is a criminal running for office called Hillary Clinton. No matter how much information they say we find out about her, the crimes, the allegations, the corruption. I mean, this would be enough to send somebody at least waiting for trial, you know, in a cell. And this woman is running around, and there is part of humanity, at least half of America, they are completely in some sort of a state of a coma. Like they don't even react. They don't even think. And if you say something, they look at you like almost you're crazy. I mean, we have already created an experimentation, mind control. I don't know if this is going to be through technology or just through the school system and through the television. And by the way, it's another instrument. So, but we already have this level of mind control. So I think now what they're trying to achieve with this extra technology, they can go to the next stage. They can start to say, by the way, we're going to drive you crazy and you will kill yourself pretty soon or you will be destitute. Don't you think that pretty much part of what they're trying to do in the future or maybe in the near future to all of us?
Yes, I believe so. I believe it's a form of genocide. It's a depopulation program for sure, because we're losing hundreds in targeted individuals who are in a weak state. You know, if they're hurt to a massive amount, you know, they become exhausted and just the pain is unbearable sometimes, and targeted individuals do take their lives. Unfortunately, that is the goal, so that they can say, aha, I told you he was crazy.
You say something very important you said, and I tell you something. Normally, you know, I don't talk about, I have a part of me that nobody knows. I'm on the air, I talk about many personal things. There's a little world that is very private. And the only reason why I share it now, because I think it's important. And, you know, as I said, I'm not here to say, oh, this is a target individual school. No, I wish you were wrong. I wish that I could prove that this is just a bunch of crap and it's just in your mind. I wish. But I tell you something.
I wish I could wake up and it would all be over.
Yeah. I had an interview, my first interview with Mrs. Karen Stewart, okay? And I had, you know, an open mind. I thought that she had a lot of credibility, at least as a former NSA whistleblower. I mean, not everybody can work for the NSA, okay? You must have some sort of education, of course, a sort also a background check. So you're a credible person, okay? And she started to talk about all these things. I do my research. She said, by the way, I already had a pretty much open mind, and I already was pretty sure about many things I could prove, okay? Now, even 3-4 days after, I started to have, out of the blue in my mind, sounds, people talking to me. I said, what the heck? This is, must be just in my imagination, you know, after you listen to this interview a few times. And then it keeps going into another dimension that means really almost like, oh, my God. For 2 weeks, I thought something really, I must be really reading too much into this. But guess what? I realized it wasn't about my suggestion. It was something completely different and, more important, when I was going close to areas, that normally they have these big antennas, okay, like in cities. I live in rural America, thank God. But when I go to town and there are these sort of a big new cell phone towers or whatever, I start to feel very something stronger. And also about emotions. I'm a very, you know, normal guy, okay? I don't take any drugs. I'm happy. You know, I don't even like to use the word depressed because, you know, I always believe that
I don't even smoke cigarettes. I don't drink. I don't do drugs.
You know, I mean, I like to drink wine, but I'm a very happy guy. You know, I'm peaceful and everything else. But sometimes I was going close to some areas that I realized there were two things in common. There were these towers, or there were like these sort of new smart meters. And my mood started to change pretty bad. And I'm not even talking about violent because I'm not violent. I'm always keeping it under control, that part of me. I'm never really a violent person. But I tell you, going like almost moody in a way, switch mood, that I say, oh, my God, what's going on? So I tell you, this is something that we – then I did the research. And there was another guest that I had with me a few months ago. I forgot his name. He's a black guy, very interesting guy, very knowledgeable guy. He was arrested, not even arrested, he was put into this sort of asylum for 2 weeks. I'm sure you remember his name, maybe. He was
Yes,
I had him on the show.
He's my good friend, yes.
Yeah. So, I mean, he was telling me things that I did the research after I did the interview with him, how they can somehow create these emotions in your mind, just manipulating this sort of a wavelength that they can do towards your brain. So any point, the point is science. There is a science out there. Now, the point is why they want to do it. They want to exterminate us like rats. But more important, I really believe they want first experiment on us to see how we, you know, how we behave before we go to the final point. Now, my point is how can we defend ourselves? How can we at least resist? Because probably there is no way really we can shield ourselves, but we need to fight. What do you think? Since you are a person right there,
When this first started, I noticed that people were just watching me. They watched me shop. They watch you to see what you buy. They watch you to see your style, what you like, what you eat, what you buy, your patterns, your behavior patterns. They study that. They study your friends, how you interact with them. They probe to see what provokes violence, what provokes you to sadness, what provokes you to, you're like a little puppet. And, they study every single aspect of your life and before they actually start harassing you. And, they find the things that mean the most to you and take that away from you and break you down slowly but surely. And for me, it was my children. And they actually murdered my daughter. And
first of all, if you don't want to answer, you don't have to answer. But since you mentioned that, can you give us more details? And if you don't want, you don't have to answer,
yes,
of course.
My daughter was... my daughter was injected in her back with a drug to stop her heart, and it stopped her heart immediately. They've actually arrested a couple that befriended her, came into her private domain, and actually did this in her bedroom. And so...
Who did that? Who exactly was the perpetrator, if you can know? Did anybody got found guilty?
It was, well, this is still under investigation. They have been arrested. It was a couple, and they were portraying to be her friend. The lady's name is Monica, and the man, I forgot the man's name, but they're both in jail right now for the murder of my daughter. And this didn't come until almost 2 years later.
And when that happened, if I can ask you again, when exactly the crime?
October 3rd of 2014.
Wow, so it's recent. Wow.
Yeah,
sorry about
that. Two of my daughters, my granddaughters, were actually put up for adoption.
Oh, my God.
And my sister that participates in this crime has my two older ones. The two younger ones were put up for adoption. And I had no say in this whatsoever. My sister had me deemed medically unfit to take care of my grandchildren and immediately went for custody of the two oldest ones and separated the two younger ones. She had them adopted out.
Adopted to some stranger?
Yes, my sister had the two younger ones adopted out, and she has the two older ones.
Why is this so sad? I tell you, you know, from outside, you know, even if I don't know your story, okay? Even if I don't believe anything you're saying, if I was your sister or your brother, okay? The last thing I would like to have to adopt our family, you know, I'm talking about grandchildren, mm-hmm. okay, to some stranger. I mean...
Exactly.
Okay, let's put it this way. Let's say when I really be greedy, okay, I keep them all for myself, okay? But not to some sort of, who knows, some stranger that's going to have maybe, I mean, this is so sad. I mean, you separate the family. I mean, we're talking about brothers and sisters or anyway, kids that they are together. And now they're going to live, grow up into different families. Is that the case? I mean, you're talking
when this happened, I suffered, I was immediately diagnosed with cancer, and I was immediately diagnosed with having a stroke.
Oh, my God.
I went into cardiac arrest, and I had a lot of medical problems. However, I am cancer-free today, thank you, Jesus, but I am still suffering with my heart. I'm actually having another heart surgery. This is caused from electronic harassment.
You know, can I say something? Even if there is not electronic harassment, I would have a heart attack too after all the things you just had to witness, starting from the sad news about the crime against your daughter. I mean, the murder of your daughter, just right there. And then you see your grandson and granddaughters. I mean, being separated and being adopted. I mean, that's heartbreaking right there. I'm not trying to bring give you less credit or other things. I'm sure that there is also some other plans that they are trying to do. But just that type of misery and bad news in your life, that's heartbreaking. I mean, I'm amazed you're still even talking to me over the phone, because I don't know if I would have the energy even to share all this information with the world. There is a point that, my God, you know, seriously. So, listen, one thing you mentioned, you know, and normally I keep my religion for myself. I'm a Christian myself, but in this show I bring everybody. I don't care if you are atheist, Buddhist, whatever you are. All I care that you respect each other and are your mother welcome. But you say something important, and I think I completely share the same view. You mentioned the name Jesus, and at least it's your strength. And I tell you, I noticed that when I was in this 2 weeks period, very stressed out, having this sort of a very metaphysic experience, you know, coming down to a point that, oh, my God, am I really for real? That I start to listen to these sounds in my mind or voices. Guess what? Every time they were starting to say something stupid, I say, you know what, go away. And I found my strength in my belief.
Yes.
That's where it's almost like a journey. It's almost like a challenge. It's almost like a test. And I tell you, at the end, after 2 weeks, they were gone. Maybe I wasn't interested enough. I don't know. Maybe hopefully they're gone forever. But my point, I say, I don't care. You do what you want. I do not care.
It's funny that you say that, because I haven't experienced the voice of school lately. They stopped actually about 5 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
Like I say, most of the attacks on me have been very physical, because right after my daughter passed away. I didn't even have time to grieve when my church actually turned against me and started doing these gaslighting techniques and smear campaigns. And the people that I cleaned house for had started driving me and causing me to collapse. And I literally thought I was going to die, and I didn't know where it was coming from. I was suspicious of everybody.
By the way, you know, I want
because.
Go ahead, finish, go please. Ahead. Finish. I have something important after you finish. Go ahead.
Because I was suspicious of everybody because it seemed to be right after a church meal together that I was collapsing and having severe problems walking and noticed that I was being drugged. And I finally narrowed it down to the people that I was cleaning house for. And so I no longer attend that church. And guess what? I have no more problems with being drugged.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God.
But I am to a point where I can't even walk down the street. People spray chemicals on me. Wow. And these are chemicals that wet your clothing and you break out with a rash from head to toe.
Yeah.
So it's very evident that what they're doing is illegal.
Let me say something, you know, because I always to back up these things by facts, okay? When we say voice voice to skull, this is directly from the Army website. By the way, the page has been removed, but you can find it on wires.com, an article in 2008, okay? Army removes the page voice to skull device. By the way, you could be able to buy for a few thousand dollars on eBay. Not anymore in the U.S., but in Europe, this sort of a low-tech version, I mean, available for civilians, of voice-to-skull. That means that you can have this sort of instrument that you can direct the frequency to somebody's brain, and only that person will listen to sounds or voice that you are programming. That's available for civilians. There is, of course, the military version that you have no idea. I mean, we have an idea, but completely different budget, different type of technology. So the point is, that was doable in 1974. Do a research, voice to skull army. Okay? That's a weapon they have. Now, my point is, you really trust this government so much after all the corruption that we've seen, what they're doing, what they're allowing. There is no more even the basic rule of law. When you saw a woman or a devil called Hillary Clinton, that she can break every law on the book, every laws on the book, and be completely unpunished. I mean, I'm talking about corruption to the top level. It's all connected. So yes, it's very possible that there is a part of government who use this technology for nefarious purposes, unfortunately, or for even just personal agendas. So, and that's my point. So I really want to invite everybody, when we say, oh, no, it's not possible, you know, the sound in your mind, are you crazy? Guess what? It is out there, and it's all technology. It's from the 70s, okay? So that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
And that's why I say, you know, normally I have a Sunday show, okay? I cannot talk about one topic like this every Sunday. But last few months, I really realized how important this topic is. It is. Targeted individuals may sound something conspiracy for many people, but when you start to understand this is real, what is more important? The show is called Love, Guns, and Freedom, okay? If you are becoming a zombie and they can control your mind, we will not have any more freedom. That's for sure. We're going to be slave and we don't even know. We are not even going to be aware that we are slave. And for sure, we're not going to have love. We're going to be so broke down that we're going to be in misery for the rest of our lives if we have a life. And of course, forget about the guns part. They're going to probably shoot you with you're going to use your own gun to shoot yourself. The point is, this is a very serious topic, and the moment that I understood that this is real, even if it's my humble little radio show, I cannot keep my mouth shut. Once you know there is evil out there, all I'm trying to do is say, please, for the person out there that is still skeptical, person that may say, are you kidding me? Guess what? Please have an open mind. Don't trust me. Don't trust Carla. Start to do your own researches. And as I said at the beginning of the show, not everybody that was claiming to be a targeted individual, it is. No, that's not the case. But I tell you, unfortunately, there is a big part of these people that they are part of a program. And now you can see how humanity is being manipulated. You can see how it's being controlled. And look out there. You know, we don't even need to go into this voice to skull. Look at the television, what has created. Look at the school system, the public re-education camps, as they call them, what has created. Look at now, we have people that don't even know the president, the name of their government. I mean, they are completely in a catatonic zombie state. What better way to control them? You know, and the drugs and medications, and the GMO food, I mean, and the BPA, and the fluoride in the water, and the vaccines. You put all this together, I really believe it's already there, a part of controlling your mind, or at least to completely dumb you down. Let's put it this way. They start to, first of all, to dumb you down. And when you remove also your beliefs, your faith, then when you are more vulnerable, as we were saying before, let's find a way to fight back. And I believe that one thing helped me out was, first of all, faith. And I don't care whatever it's your faith, I'm not going to judge. You do whatever you want. But whatever works for you, better be a good, positive message of love. Okay? That's all I tell you. And that's what helped me out. It helped me out. I want to give you the floor. We're almost at the end, by the way. It's kind of unbelievable. But Carla Grady, Targeted Individual, you're on Love, Guns, and Freedom. I give you the floor again.
Yeah, I want to tell you, you know, the best thing that you can do is keep love in your heart and keep forgiveness in your heart, regardless of what religion you are. Just find things to make you happy. And, you know, I believe that a lot of this is used to weaken your state of mind. And if it can weaken your state of mind, they can take your soul, you know. And that's the main thing, is don't let them take the love from your heart. Don't let them take your soul. And not everybody is out to get you, regardless of what they try to make you think. They try to infiltrate you so much that they try to make you believe that everything is about you and everything is, and everybody hates you and everything. You know, there are people who won't participate in this, and it's very clear that there are some good people out there who won't do this. And my advice would be stick with those people. Try to surround yourself with people who wouldn't participate in this.
Yes, and also another thing important, you know, sometimes they put you in this state of paranoia, that then you're not going to live anymore your life. And you think everything is out there to get you, and then they win at that point. You know, I have, for example, a friend that I know personally, okay, that I think, you know, probably, yes, he has a very good chance that he's part of this program, but then he creates 50% of his own problems, he creates on his own. Because I say, okay, you know, you understand that's what's going on, but at that point, if you give in, if you completely surrender, and you think that everybody out there is trying to get you, you don't have any moral life. You're creating the rest of the drama to yourself, you know?
Exactly.
So I say always, yes, at that point, cope with that. Try to you know, find a way that it doesn't harm you. But the same way, I really believe it should be something that, you know, you need to almost give them the middle finger and say, you know, I don't care. I'll try to be happy. I'll try to be a good person. I'll try to have a decent life. With or without you, I mean, even if you try to put me down, I will try the best I can to be a human being that doesn't have to live in fear. Otherwise, every time we go around, we're always going to say, oh, my God, that person could be one of them, and then you don't have any friend. Or the job may be a part of the setup, and then you don't have a job. I mean, come on. At that point, you know it's happening. Try to find a way to almost say, no, I don't care. That's why they realize that really sometimes they get so mad when it doesn't work on you anymore, you know?
When you use your faith, you find that inner strength to overcome this. You find the things that you can distract yourself, take a walk, go to a movie, you know, go for a bike ride, go fishing, whatever it is you enjoy doing, keep doing that.
Yep. Physical exercise, by the way, another thing I really believe it's important, a good diet. Because, you know, people sometimes try to say, oh, I have a little bit of depression. And And you go to the doctor, and of course, what it does, it gives you a bunch of medication, and it's going to destroy your brain, in my opinion. You know, I'm not a doctor, but I tell you, I would never take any mental medication. I saw what it does to some of my friends, and it's completely...
Me either.
It is terrible to you. You better stay with your depression.
No.
You know? But my point is, of course, physical exercise and diet. Diet is so important. If you eat junk food, you don't have the nutrition that helps your brain to be having all the chemicals that you need to be in a good mood. I mean, unfortunately, it's true. You know, if you have a lack of vitamins, a lack of minerals and proteins, you know, your mood is going to be part of a reaction of what happens with your body. I mean, endorphins, they're not just an illusion. They're a science. So eat good food. Try to have a good diet. Have physical exercise. Find faith in whatever or wherever you believe. And try to really have an attitude to say, you know what? I don't care. I'll do my best. I'm not going to surrender to you guys. Okay? Listen, Carla, I want to help you up with a prayer. You know, whatever I can do, I'm here. I thank you for your time. I pray for you. For your family, I'm sorry to hear about your daughter. More important, I hope you're going to have now this surgery with a positive result. And is there a way people can help you out, maybe support you or just give you a thank you? Or
Yes. If anybody wants to make a financial contribution, I have my PayPal account. They can do paypal.me/Carla Grady. That's CarlaGrady.
And what is your Facebook page? Can you say again the Facebook page?
My Facebook page is Carla Grady.
Okay, just Carla Grady. Perfect. Listen, Carla, meanwhile, you know, it's funny because we were talking. I have all these strange people start to contact me for the first time on Facebook. That's very funny, but not really. Okay, listen, guys and girls, you're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with Luca Zanna. Ready for our number two. We talk about guns. And as I said, this is a very important topic. Sometimes, you know, I put a lot of extra time into this. But I think we have no choice. Once you realize that this is real and can be devastating, this can be the most terrible weapon against humanity. And it is no joke. It is no joke. That's why I'm here. I try to give you this journey, the beginning of the journey. It's up to you to finish it, or at least to continue it. Because in this show, in 3 hours, I couldn't even bring you the all evidence, or at least I just try to bring you a little bit of glimpse what can happen to a human being when they go through this sort of a drama. Anyway, if you want to support the show, you know how to do it. You can go to zanna.us. There is my new ebook, Lyrics and Poems by Gianluca Zanna, available on Amazon for $2.99. Of course, you can download any of my songs at zanna.us for just 99 cents. And why ask you that? Because I tell you, to talk about these topics on the show, if I go to the average sponsors out there, they would laugh at me. They would probably throw the book at me, okay? So, are you kidding me? No, I can talk about these things because I have your support. That's what I'm telling you. Otherwise, I couldn't do it. So even 99 cents, it really helps at the end of the month. Because it takes energy, it takes time. And also at the end of the day, you know, I just do this because I believe it's right. I don't care if people laugh at me or not. I do not care. Okay, ready for our number two? You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with Luca Zanna.
You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with Luca Zanna on United States FM. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with Luca Zanna on United States FM.
Here we go, guys and girls. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom on KTOX 1340 AM and on United States FM network. This is the hour about guns, second hour. Well, normally you know what happens here. You know, it's about training, mindset, more important, rights. You know, it's a right. Okay, this is not a sport for me. You know, when it comes down to guns, I'm not going to talk to you about the last $3,000 rifle or which rifle you should have. I don't care. It is about your heart, your mind, your will to be free. But regardless, we are close to the elections time. And we will talk a little bit about guns too, of course. But in this Sunday show, I will do a little exception. I always like when I see at least a young blood interacting and injecting themselves into politics, especially in Mojave County politics, because I tell you, I've been here 12 years. There are a lot of good things, but also there are things that really suck. And one thing really I hate about, you know, I don't want to use the word hate, but I'm say I'm disappointed with this county. It is the this sort of a cronyism when it comes down to political arena. First of all, everything must have an elephant in front. You know, if you don't have an elephant behind your ass, you're not going to make it here. Simple as that. So everything is Republican. Then even if there is a coyote running for office and is the only dog in the arena, but just because he has an elephant on his butt, he's going to get the votes. That really sucks because it's like for me a control form. That's why 3 years ago I burned with a lot of love my Republican card. I don't have any allegiance to any party. That's why I want to stay outside from any party. I don't care which party, not even the Libertarian Party. I think parties that somehow to control us. So I'm an independent, really to the bones. I believe in America. I believe in the Constitution. I believe in the Bill of Rights. And I believe that we all are supposed to have equal rights. Simple as that. But now, you know, when I see, as I said, somebody running in Mojave County for state positions and that belongs to a third party that normally I don't know much about it, I must tell you. I have some ideas. In this case, it's the Green Party. I say, you know what? Yes, I want to be on the show. Be happy to have you, especially this is the last show before the elections. So I will have a chance to meet the man, introduce him, of course, to you. But more important, I'd like to know more about him myself because I have no idea really what he's about. I don't even know if he's into the Second Amendment or if he's – I have no idea. So let me shut up and let me bring him on. By the way, this time, finally, I will be able to pronounce this name in a decent way, okay, because his name is Leo-Biasiucci. That is a very Italian name all the way. Okay, Leo, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there. Yeah, that you said it perfectly. A lot of people can't say that.
At least I always screw up, you know, British name, but at least with the Italian name, I got it right. Okay, listen, Leo, I give you the floor. You know, I want you to introduce yourself. Then, of course, I will ask you some questions. You're running for office for the state representative office, correct me if I'm wrong, and for the District 5. But I'll give you the floor, like, you know, in front of the potential audience of voters, and then, of course, I will ask you some questions. Go ahead. Who is Leo Biasiucci, and which part are you running for, and everything else, blah, blah, blah. Go ahead.
Perfect. Thank you, Luca. My name is Leo Biasiucci. I'm running for the House of Representatives here in District 5, which actually includes La Paz County and Mojave County. And I'm actually born and raised here in Lake Havasu City. So my parents came from Italy, both my mom and dad, and they moved to Lake Havasu in the mid-70s. You know, how they found Havasu, I still don't understand how that happened, but they did, and you know, they've loved it here, and so have I. I've seen it grow to what it's become, and I went to school here. I went to the high school, graduated in 2000, and then I went off to the University of Arizona and graduated with a degree in business administration and management from the Elder College of Business. And after that, I've worked for companies such as General Electric as a financial auditor. I've worked for GEICO. And right now I'm the owner and CFO of Mojave Traffic School, which we're regulated by the Arizona Department of Transportation. Okay. And we teach traffic school in Mojave County. So Bullhead, Lake Havasu, Kingman. We actually go down to Yuma as well. So if you get a speeding ticket, if you get a even up to a DUI, we teach those classes as well. You come through our program to get yourself back on the road and kind of just, you know, get your to really understand the laws and you know, everybody makes a mistake and we understand that. And so when people come to class, we just really, we're there to let them understand, hey, you know, this is what you did wrong and, you know, just understand what happened and let's get you back to where you need to be. So it's, I love the program because it's not about pointing fingers or, telling somebody they, you know, messed up or they're the problem. It's just a matter of, you know, let's understand the situation and make sure they're back on the road safely. So.
Okay.
But I've been doing that for about 10 years, and really about 2 years ago is when I decided I wanted to run for the House, and I was watching the state bill or the state budget get balanced, and I kept seeing more and more cuts happening, in particular to education. I mean, I come from a family of educators. My mom's a teacher. My uncle was a superintendent in Lake Havasu. I have a couple more uncles and aunts are teachers. My sister-in-law is a teacher. My cousin's a teacher. So I've seen education turn to the disaster I personally believe it's become now in this state. And it came to a point where I kept complaining, and I kept hearing people complain about Arizona and all the cuts that were happening, especially the education. And it came to a point I said, you know, I can continue to complain, or I can actually do something about it. And I figured, you know, why not do something like run for a political office? And the reason I chose the House is because, you know, I don't think a lot of people understand what the House does. And really, as a legislator, you write the bills. I mean, you write the law. And you represent your district in these laws. And so I figured, you know, what a better place to be than in a position to write a law that says, you know, you can't steal education money that's supposed to go to it. Or, you know, I should be able to write a bill that's going to help everybody across the line. Cause, you know, that's why I'm running. I want to do what's best for everybody. I don't care about political parties. I mean, okay. You know, Republican, independent, it doesn't matter.
I have a question.
And that's the reason why I'm running.
Leo, I have a question. You know, you could have ran, of course, if you wanted to, for any party. You could have run for the Republican ticket, a Democrat ticket, and you chose the, correct me if I'm wrong, the Green Party ticket. Am I right?
Right.
I mean, normally, you know, I'm not trying to pass a judgment, because I tell you, my opinion, sure. They fail us all. I don't see much difference almost in budgets, even between Democrats, Republicans, especially at county level. The Republicans, yeah, they're spending more than the liberals, in my opinion, when it comes down to taxation. But regardless, why did you choose the Green Party? Maybe you didn't go for the Democrat Party. I'm just curious. I mean, they pretty much tried to.
Yeah.
Always, what is the difference?
Right, I could have chose any party, right? I mean, in my mind, to be honest with you, I think there are good things about every party. I think there are good people in every party. I mean, it doesn't really matter who's Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, because in my mind, I think people can provide, you know, good things in any party. And the only reason I went more towards the Green on this election cycle is because I kind of wanted to bring into the limelight a little more about environmental. I mean, we live in a county where the Colorado rivers are, you know, that's our lifeline, right? I mean, that really provides us with all of our income, if you really break it down. And we also live in a county that has just endless amount of land. I mean, we have so much land out here. I know a lot of it is federal, which that's a whole other topic. But you know, why aren't we the leader in solar? Why aren't we the leader in wind? And that's something I kind of wanted to, you know, go on the green side, because I know that the Green Party does talk about that more than probably any other party. But if you sit here and ask, you know, am I really a full Green Party member? I mean, in honesty, no. I mean, I think there are great things about every party. And, you know, at the level of the Green Party, I mean, I'm not fully endorsed by them, so, and I don't really care. But my main thing is, how can I also bring those topics up? And I think when people think green, they ask me those questions. Like, well, you know, mm-hmm. you're running green, so why? And I could say, well, you know, we don't want to become a California, right? I mean, we do a great job of protecting our water right now, but how do we make sure that stays that way? How do we make sure we don't turn into that? And how do we get more solar projects into town and into our county? How do we, you know, use our land to our benefit and get off the grid? I mean, Unisource, I was sat in a meeting here in Havasu when they came in about the rate hike in front of the commission, and 99.9% of the people were against it, which it makes sense. I mean, you have a company who makes millions of dollars in net profit, right? I think something like 130, 140 million in net. I mean, they're taking that home at the end of the day after all their bills, mm-hmm. and they're still raising rates. That, to me, is ridiculous. Yeah. That even went through and it got approved even after all the backlash from the people. And that's the stuff I don't agree with. And I think it's time we move to a new direction. I mean, whether we bring in another company or we make that push to solar. I mean, we make the push to alternative energies because
Leo, but
it's there. Know, we're just not putting the money there.
Sorry to interrupt you, because, you know, this electric bill story, it really bugs me a lot for many reasons, because it starts to sound more and more like Italy that I left, because that used to be what is called the monopoly. Okay. That means the government controls pretty much the market. There is no free market. There is no competition. In this case, we have a private corporation that does the same job like the government does in Italy, okay? So that means when there is no option, they can screw you the way they want. This is the food, the meal. If you don't like it, guess what? Tomorrow is going to be still there. That's all you eat. So the point is, my opinion, that one thing that really I wish in America would be changing, that we as a consumers, we would have the opportunity to have at least two choices, because I could at least say, you know what, Unisource, screw you. You know, you can get your smart meter and put it in the back of your butt if you want. I'm not going to go with that. And maybe I have an alternative with we can compete. They can compete. Instead, we have one company only for the area, and yes, it's private, but technically it is more of a form of a fascism, because, you know, if you're probably you're familiar, the definition of fascism, according to Benito Mussolini, was the union between the corporation and the state. So we have a state that controls and regulates the corporation, and that's what it means, that, and we are living under fascism. And the fees, they will rise, and we have this sort of a little meetings that they can make us feel good, that we can complain for a while. But at the end, if they really push it, guess what? We're going to eat whatever bills they're going to send. So what do you think? You think it's going to be possible one day to have maybe at least two choices, to have at least two different corporations that we can they can run, you know, compete for our business?
I mean, I think that you said it perfectly. You know, I mean, why don't we have two companies here? Mm-hmm. And why is there a monopoly in the energy? I mean, people should have that choice, right? I mean, and even when you look at the customers here that went to solar, Unisource came in and said, well, we're going to charge you a fee for being on solar.
Yeah.
And that's ridiculous, right?
Exactly.
I mean, you're punishing somebody for using an alternative energy source because you're mad they're not using your energy. I mean, and when you look at it, you think, you know, I sat there and I stood up in front of the commission and I said that. I said, look, you guys, your job as the Arizona Corporation Commission is to protect the people, right? I mean, they decide, well, you know, should the rate go up? What are the situations? And like I told you, like 99% of the people, I think there were one or two people that were for it, and I'm pretty sure they were paid, mm-hmm. you know, lobbyists from Phoenix, because they weren't from here. And, you know, when you have that, that's really discouraging, right? I mean, you have the commission, 99% of the people say no, they don't want this, and it still happens. What's the point of the commission anymore? I mean, are they not there for the people anymore? And I think that's the issue with government, right? You have people who, is there corruption? I don't know. There could be. I mean, it's just that should not have ever happened in that situation, and it still did, and that's not okay. And I think the only way that changes is if you get non-politicians into political positions
mm-hmm.
who don't have their hands in the pockets of other people or corporations or companies.
Oh, I understand. And, you know, this is interesting because you are like a Green Party member, or at least running under the Green Party ticket. But as you said, you're not exactly 100% hardcore Green Party. And, you know, I think every human being, that unless he's crazy or she's crazy, is supposed to be to defend the nature. I mean, nobody, I think, wants to live in a polluted area or destroy.
Right.
This is okay. I mean, it's normal common sense, okay? Unless you're crazy, that's another story. But there is a point, there is a point that I really believe there is also manipulation, in my opinion. For example, I have a specific question for you, you know? How do you feel about, this is something normally the Green Party and the Democratic Party, they're pushing a lot, that to save the world, we got to pay the carbon tax. What do you think about that?
You know, I mean, I think that's the one side where I'm probably more on the Republican side on taxes. I mean, in having that kind of control, I don't like if there's a tax when is it, I mean, is the information accurate? Is all the information there saying that we need to have a carbon tax? I mean, is that just a way for them to make more money? You know, that's something I don't like. When, you know, there's more government control over people in general. And so unless a tax has a specific purpose that's really going to go to the intent that it's going to, I mean, I personally don't like it. I mean, it's kind of like if you look at any propositions that come up, what's the intent behind it? Is there more than just what they're telling you? I mean, that's why I like to research a lot of things.
Let's say for a moment, you know, first of all, we have enough evidence right now from scientists that this global warming, you know, it is not what they've been told. You know, the emails found at the United Nations, the scandals. I mean, this is out there. out there. People want to look at, want to look for facts and not just believe some sort of mantra or some sort of, you know, guru belief. You know, I'll try to be scientific, okay? We have no connection to human activities, to global warming. There are different factors. And so much that we have maybe even less than global warming. But regardless, let's say for a moment, yes, global warming is real, hypothetically. This is for me to the fact that government can tax us. And we're going to pay a tax, and then the global warming is going to disappear. That reminds me the time during the Pope, 1600, when you pay for your sins to the Pope, and then you go to heaven. I mean, seriously. That's what exactly happened. Same story here. The difference now, we don't have the Pope, but we have some other scumbags, for example, like Al Gore, or other people that they've been pretty much... creating this system that they are behind this carbon tax exchange, and they can completely benefit also economically. So that's the reality. You know, to save the environment, I think it's supposed to be a common goal for every human being. But at the same time, you know, what they're trying to do here, they try to create a futuristic system where they can pretty much decide if you're going to survive or not. I mean, for example, you're familiar that now the Obama administration with the EPA in Arizona, since we are coming back to what could be your area of interest if you get elected, we have different carbon plants, you know, that they produce electricity, of course. And with the new regulations and the new extreme system of upgrades, pretty much to compensate the new cost that these plants they're going to have, we're going to have a skyrocketing increase in electric bills. And there is no justification. For example, there is the big plant that is exactly on the 40, just outside the area of Holbrook. I don't know if you're familiar with that plant. And there was a big meeting just a couple of years ago. And all the idea of the EPA said that because they see some smoke, some clouds coming at the Grand Canyon. And by the way, I have another theory about that. But regardless, what do you think about this EPA dictating to our businesses in Arizona this complete, in my opinion, Stalinist rules, and more important, they are not even laws, because at least, you know, if something coming from a legislation, we may talk about it. These are just bureaucrats with a lot of ink and paper. They can pretty much decide how much we're going to pay for the next electric bill. What do you think about the EPA?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the EPA, you know, their purpose, if you look at their purposes, I mean, it's a good thing, right? They're trying to protect the environment. I mean, that's their goal. But, you know, going back to what you're talking about, you know, with whether it's, you know, our planet's becoming more polluted, if global warming is real, you know, what facts do we have? I mean, if you really research it, you can see that, you know, are we contributing to our climate change? Maybe, but also, our planet goes through cycles, right? I mean, this is scientifically proven. I mean, we always go through cycles, whether it's, you know, an ice age or warming, and we are kind of in that pattern right now. Is it coming faster than usual? Possibly, but I mean, for things like the carbon tax, you know, what's that really doing? I mean, you're taxing the people because they're using the fuel, right? They're using, you know, gasoline, for example. You're contributing to our planet, you know, speeding up into global warming. But is that really doing anything? If you think about it, I mean, like, look, you have taxes on cigarettes. If people stop smoking, even though they know it's unhealthy, I mean, maybe, but people still do it. I mean, people are still going to do that. So I think it's silly that, you know, you have these regulations coming in saying, like, you know, we're going to, you know, put this into place and that's going to stop it. Because in my mind, like, the evidence isn't there, like, completely for them to do something like that. And on top of that, you're putting a tax on people, right? Like, what, for what reason? Because they're using, why not think of other ways to, why don't we push it towards solar? There's so much money that we can take from the government instead of putting whatever tax breaks or whatever incentives towards these, you know, nuclear or coal. Why don't we start shifting that to cleaner energy instead of taxing the people? For you're almost punishing the people. Mm-hmm. For what? For something that you provide. I mean, it's not like we have a choice. I mean, we do, but I mean, oil has been the way of energy for so long.
You know, Leo, you're punishing. You know, Leo, there is a lot of knowledge, suppressed knowledge out there. I mean, I saw the other day, you know, the other day, it's been for a while. I remember 10 years ago, there was on Fox News, and you can still find probably on YouTube the video, this scientist, American scientist, who was able to pretty much have a vehicle will run some water. Okay? And
right.
Open Ninja, you can see it. It works great. This guy died, by the way, mysteriously, 1 year later. But regardless, the point is we have so much technology. And the point is, I think the people, we should have at least the chance to choose. And I think free market would be a very good way to create this desire. Because, you know, right now we don't have many options. They give us, of course, the options of the oil, because that's where they make their money. They can screw us every week when we have to fill our tank. And then, of course, as you said, nuclear. Everybody sounds like it's so great, but I ask you, a politician, would you like to live next to that nuclear plant? Probably they would run. No, it's true. You know, we have in Mojave County politicians, and I don't want to mention names, Buster Jones, so I give you one, okay, that I know that he was pushing for that. Correct me if I'm wrong, Buster Jones. So I think he's for in pro of these nuclear plants. And I would like to ask him or anybody else there who really believe that nuclear is the answer, would you like to have your kids playing around a nuclear plant? Would you like to have your garden growing next to a nuclear plant? Would you like to have your home in front of a nuclear plant? And, you know, I believe that, you know, I'm not a Green Party guy. I'm a regular guy, but I try to use my brain, probably like you, okay?
Sure.
I say one thing. We are human beings. We are fallible. Otherwise, we'd be God, okay? If you think you are infallible, you are not human. We are humans. So we screw up. Simple as that. We try to do less as possible. You know, I can make a mistake with the oil. Yes, we're going to have a spill. It's going to be a mess. Hopefully, we're going to clean it up. If I make one mistake with a nuclear plant, just one, we're going to contaminate this land for 20,000 years. That's a fact. So can we afford...
Japan, right?
Japan. I mean, look at Japan. The arrogant bastards.
Still,
you know,
leaking.
Yeah, it's still leaking. And we are eating their freaking fish that we're going to die one day thinking about how much money they save, these bastards, okay?
So that's
my point. I see this. I hope every human being out there, every listener, I don't care if you're Republican, Democrats, Libertarian, start to use your brain. Don't follow the orders from your party. Because I hate when I see the good old boys, especially in the Republican Party, you mention, you know, the magic word, uranium. Oh, it's good for the economy. And they have no freaking clue. By the way, uranium is being sold all to Russian companies, idiots. We don't make a dime out of that, okay?
All the good,
I mean, they think, oh, it's so good for Mojave County. Uranium, you idiot. You understand what happens when the stuff spills in our water and it goes in our aquifer? And by the way, you think it's so good for us? What do we get out of us? By the way, when I'm dead, I don't care how much money I have. I'm going to still have cancer, okay? But my point is, regardless, seriously, stop following the orders from your party boss. Use your brain. You know, he is not talking, I'm not, as I said, I'm not a Green Party guy, but I believe that there is a point. We use common sense and nuclear energy, I think. It is probably, in my opinion, one of the last things we want to do, unless we want to be arrogant. We want to be like God. We think we are God, but we are not. We make one mistake. Japan, Fukushima is a reminder. That's it. So I'll give you the floor. What other alternative you think we could do right now besides the solar and wind? Because, you know, any other thing you think? Because I hate when I see government try to push things like Obama does. For example, try to give a government money, tax dollar to corporations. But what would be your plan in case you get in office to try to draft a legislation that we can open, let's say, for example, to customers, to consumers, to us, opportunity to have a more accessible, let's say, alternative energy?
Right. And you know, I think with the nuclear energy part, I mean, if you, like you said, I know that you said there's people and political power that still believe that's a viable energy source. But you and I and anybody with common sense knows how dangerous it is, right? I mean, anybody who actually looks at Japan sees that it's still leaking to this day into the ocean. And when you sit there and still have people who support it, that really blows my mind. Even with coal, I mean, how many people need to die in coal mines before we decide that it's time to move forward? And you know, I think what it comes down to is, you're right, you know, we need to stop having politicians in power who are just going to follow the party line. When does the common sense come in as a politician? When do you say, enough's enough, we need to do what's best for everybody,
you know,
right?
What,
and when you look at energy, oh, go ahead.
Leo, you know, Leo, at least the coal mine, you know, I still have the free choice if I want to go underground or die or not. It's my choice. If I like the type of environment,
sure.
I want to work, it's, you know, nobody's pushing me. Even if the coal mine explodes, I'm sorry, not to compare to a nuclear blast, okay, that's going to stay here thousands of years. So that's the reality, you know, I think. And more important, you know, politicians can say whatever they want. I'm not even blaming them. because they get paid off most of the time anyway. They do their job, okay?
Right.
The problem is the people. They don't use their brain, and we are the responsible.
Right.
That's what I really believe. So let me just switch topic because, you know, it's a very interesting topic, this part, but, you know, I like other things. I like to at least know about you and know more a little bit about you. Okay, talking about state government, okay? For example, there are different ways that I always say government doesn't really supposed to create jobs. The government, for me, government, the only way can create jobs is leave us the hell alone. And we see, and that way we have a better environment. Yeah, of course, we need some structures.
Right.
We need the roads. We need some sort of a basic system, like, you know, judicial system, at least to have, we don't need to go back to killing each other on the street, stuff like that. But beside that, if the government give us a break, a lower taxation and lower regulations, I think we can create jobs. We as Americans, you know. Now, what is your solution? Because I see on your Facebook, you know, jobs. What is your magic formula? How are you going to create jobs for Arizona?
Sure. I mean, I think, you know, one thing which is directly related to, in my opinion, to jobs is Prop 206, right, the minimum wage hike. That, to me, is government getting involved too much because all that's going to do is, in my opinion, is going to ruin small businesses and take jobs away. Because in my opinion, when you have a minimum wage is meant for entry level, right? Somebody, high school students or first time job, this is, you're getting minimum wage. So when you have minimum wage hikes going up and government trying to get involved in determining that, I think you're ruining our economy and you're ruining our jobs, because all that's going to happen, there are companies that are going to go out of business, the small companies, and then big companies are going to either raise their prices or they're going to remove positions, right? Or they're going to cut hours or they're going to replace people with machines.
Mm-hmm.
So one thing I agree with you, we need to leave that alone. We need to leave the idea of how to run a business or how much we should pay people. We should leave that to the companies. And in my opinion, the one way to grow any economy is education. Because when you have a solid education at the core of any county, let's say with Havasu, right, our education system is terrible. I mean, rock bottom. In the whole state, we're ranked 50th in state funding. And when you have that, what happens? I mean, no company is going to come. You know, I talked to James Gray over at the Partnership for Economic Development here in Havasu, and, you know, he tells me, you know, what do we do to ask him, what are you doing to try to get companies in town? And he'll tell me, you know, we can offer tax breaks. We can offer all these incentives. But when you have a company coming, a corporation, for example, what happens? Well, they bring executives with them, right? I mean, they bring management with them. And usually with that management come family. And the first thing that they look at is the schooling system. They want to know, you know, am I putting my child into a good school or not? And a lot of times they either don't come, or if you have like doctors, the same situation, when they come, they leave after a year because they understand how bad it really is in the state or the city. And so in my opinion, I think the first thing we need to do is really invest in the education of our children. And I'm not talking just schooling. I'm talking about critical thinking, right? I mean, how do we get these kids to think on their own?
Mm-hmm.
Because right now our whole system is just beyond just tank. I mean, it's
Leo,
it's
talking
bad.
About education, you know, I'm sure you're familiar about Common Core. What is your position on Common Core?
I mean, with Common Core, it's interesting because, you know, I do think we need to have some kind of idea of if our students are progressing or not. I mean, are they learning at all? I mean, are they actually, you know, should they be going up to the next grade? Now, do I think our government should decide that? No. I mean, I think if anybody, it should be the teacher, right? I mean, I think the teacher, they're going to know if this student should be going on. Are they learning or not? Are they progressing or not? I personally don't like that kind of control. I mean, that's, like I said, that's where I come in and say I like less government control. I think the federal government has their job. Protect our borders, protect us from outside harm, maybe protect some of our, you know, vital resources. But beyond that, leave it to the states to decide. You know, leave it to the people to decide how they want to make things work. Because I think we're smart enough, and we can be smart enough to do that. I think we've kind of been, you know, we've been holding the government's hand for so long on what to do, how to do it, and it's kind of put us in this hole of, like, we can't even think for ourselves anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and I see it through education. My parents, you know, my mom's a teacher, and she tells me, you know, it's changed in the last 15, 20 years, where, you know, it's not the same anymore. The kids aren't coming through and they're not thinking for themselves. I mean, I even, you know, volunteered at a school for a leadership class, and I mean, I was talking to seniors who are about to graduate, and they couldn't even get in front of the class and speak to anybody to make a presentation. They couldn't even call companies or businesses to ask for, you know, donate. I mean, it's a whole different mentality that's taken over. And I'm personally thinking that we need to get away from things like Common Core, and we need to really put it back into the schools. Let them be responsible. Hold them responsible.
You know what is interesting, Leo? I see my tax bill, different properties, goes up almost every year. Okay. So, and I see a big chunk public education. Okay. And, money, I think the trend has been the last probably 30 years or more. They think that throwing more money into the fire, or at least, you know, into this big bucket is going to fix the problem. I see that, first of all, you know, probably call me extreme. You know, I'm speaking for myself. I think this is, for me, is a pure form of violence when government forces me without my consent to buy a product that I do not use. And people may say, oh, but this is for the kids. I don't care. Okay. If you want to ask me for a charity, I cut your check. But don't come here with a gun pointed at my face, because if I don't pay property taxes, I'm going to lose my home. That's for me something that I had to take, you know, aspirin every year when it comes to pay this tax bill, because I feel like it's an extortion. But regardless, you know, this is just me right now thinking. The point is, I see that the money always, they want more money. I see that many people working in the school system, especially higher level ranks, you know, principals and things like that, they got the best cars, they got everything they want. But the point is, as you said, the student is still suffering. Maybe there must be something can be done more than just putting more money into the bucket, and maybe finding a way where the money really go. I mean, administering the money, being sure that we don't get ripped every time we turn around. Because I see, for example, now, correct me if I'm wrong, I heard that in Havasu, they tried to create a new bond for the school to pay extra tax. Is it right or not? Am I missing something?
Yeah, there's a school bond and override on the measure this upgrade.
I mean, you know, it's sad, you know, if somebody wants to pay for extra, I think good luck, you know, cut your check and be happy, okay? But to vote that everybody else must be forced into that, I would just run out of the town so fast and ready to live on the moon before I pay more than I've already been forced to pay. And this is just me talking, of course. But what is your position about this override and pay extra tax for the school system? Because, you know, I understand it is not, your property tax is not doing enough. But so people say, let's pay more. But as I said, what that really bugs me is not the fact that you want to pay more. Let's say tomorrow you, Leo, would you like to pay more? You want to give an extra $1,000 to the school system. Good luck. I'm happy for you. Very happy. But when you vote, when other people vote, the mob, the majority votes, that we are all forced into this common vote, that for me is called coercion. It's called socialism. And I'm ready to snap, ready to run out of that town. Seriously, if I was living in Havasu right now, I would probably ready to pack and sell my home if that bill goes through. Many people may be liking it. That's fine. I'm not disagreeing, but that's my point of view. What do you think about this override in Havasu, this extra bond?
Yeah, I mean, I think, to give you a perfect example, you have Phoenix Union Schools, okay, down in Phoenix. They spend somewhere around $11,000 per student, okay? And they're graduation rate is 73-74%. Well, Havasu, we spend about half of that per student, and our graduation rate is in the 80s, high 80s. So does money matter, right? I mean, is money obviously the difference? Obviously not. I mean, you're talking about a half is being spent on the students, and our graduation rate is higher than a school that spends double the money. So I understand that. I see that point perfectly, because, you know, if we're given the money, if, you know, you look at so 35% of education uses 35% of the state expenditures. That's what it was in 2005. So that, it's a huge chunk. I mean, it's the biggest chunk. And yet our education is still rock bottom. And at that point you think to yourselves, well, what's going on? Like you said, what's happening here? If the money is supposedly there and we're still rock bottom, then something's happening in the middle. And I couldn't agree more. I think that in my mind, the issue is a few things. Number one, I don't think we're holding the districts accountable and the state accountable as much as we should, right? I mean, I don't think there are enough audits. I think there needs to be audits, and there needs to be transparency. Where is this money going exactly? right? Where, how are you spending this? It should be like any business, right? Because if you think about it, as property owners, we own the schools, if you want to break it down, because we pay so much towards them through our taxes. We're kind of like owners. And so when you own a business, of course you want to know where that money's going and how it's being spent. And is that happening now? Not really. And I think that's a valid argument by a lot of people that don't want the bond in override in Havasu, because they say, you know what, how do I know this is not going to be just spent on pointless things and just, you know, and just, they're just going to waste the money. And how do we not know that? And it's true. But on the other side of it, the other argument, I do understand how important education is. I mean, if you look at states that spend the most on education, they're also the highest ranked.
Okay.
So it's a tough call because, you know, you're right. You know, why do you force the people to pay for education? You're demanding them. In my opinion, you have other options, right? In my opinion. I mean, you could do a tourism tax, for example, which is I know some cities do it across the U.S. Myrtle Beach, they have a 2% tax they put on their sales tax.
Mm-hmm.
It's like 2.2%. Now, it's called a tourism tax there because Myrtle Beach is a huge tourism destination. Just millions of people go there every year. Well, at the end of the year, when people file their taxes, if you're a resident of Myrtle Beach, you actually get that back. You claim that on your taxes if you show proof that you're a resident.
Mm-hmm.
So how brilliant is that? You're really just taxing the visitors that come visit. And you know as much as I do, especially in like Havasu, how big of a tourist attraction is Havasu? I mean, we thrive off of tourism.
And also another thing, you're right, Leo, this is a very important point. The point is at least it's a voluntary tax because, you can choose if you want to be part of or not. You know, the idea that just because I bought a property a long time ago and every year I need to be pay my mafia fees. That's the way I call them. This is me, of course. Don't worry. I'm not mentioning you, okay? It's pretty much worse than the mafia. But at least the mafia, you know, you can fight it back. You know, in case you don't want to pay a month, you can shoot it out a little bit. But with the government, you can't really. So you're going to lose that property if you don't pay it back. So for me, the same concept can be applied at that point, not just to your home. Why not even to your furniture? No, maybe you want all your TV.
Right.
After all, it's your property, supposedly, okay? So you create the illusion that we are really free, the illusion that we have a property, that we own property. Then the reality is every year you got to pay your fee. Then let's say for a moment, 1 year, you don't make enough money because life can be tough, especially for seniors on Social Security. You know, never know things outgo.
Sure.
Medical bill, bang, you lose that property. So that's the point, you know, if there are ways, there used to be ways that we can somehow, like a sale tax, I buy one the house, I pay the sale tax. And I think there was, by the way, a legislator in Mojave County that I had him on my show a few times, Supervisor Moss. He was mentioning an idea that I think is a great idea. I wish he could come out really with a solid plan with this one to create like some sort of a sale tax. When you buy your property, you pay once, and then at that point, till you don't sell it, you don't pay. You know, and there are the other ways, of course, as you were saying, through when you voluntarily buy items or things, you know, with a sale tax, you can compensate that budget somehow, you know. But anyway, it's an interesting topic. I'm glad that you have an open mind and you're kind of out of any type of, you know, as you said, you know, you're not Democrat, nor Republican, nor even, honestly, so much of a Greens. You know, you're more almost libertarian, in my opinion, on some issues. Now, question.
And real quick, just on the education thing, we also need to understand that we have about $5 billion in our land trust fund in Arizona,
mm-hmm.
right? We have $5 billion sitting there in that money that's supposed to be used for education. So if our legislation actually used that like it should and put that towards education, we wouldn't have bonds and overrides. We wouldn't have tax rate hikes because the money that's supposed to be going to education would be going there. Mm-hmm. And that's another issue. I mean, is the money really going there like it should? I mean, you look at Prop 123, that's a disaster. I mean, it's just more money being, you know, promised to schools and they're not getting it. So then what happens? Bonds and overrides happen. And then
let me move a couple extra topics because I want to reach as much information as possible out there. Okay, Prop 205, legalization of marijuana. Well, what is your sense on this one? What do you think? Who owns the body, us or the government? Are we allowed to smoke a plant or are we supposed to become felons because of that?
No, I mean, I think, you know, with anything, you do whatever you want to yourself, right? I mean, that's your body. It's your choice. You smoking marijuana will never affect me personally, right? Unless you get behind a car and you, you know, kill me or kill somebody, then you're held responsible.
Yeah, like alcohol, like beer, like wine, you know? I mean,
Right, exactly. But you make the choice to drink and get behind the wheel, and then you pay the consequences. But just to say you can't smoke weed and make it a law that you can't do it doesn't make sense to me. Right? So with Prop 205, I don't like how the bill was written.
Mm-hmm.
I think it could be legalized. I think it should at some point. But I don't think that it's ready right now with this bill because there's too many gray areas in there right now. And I think once we can get that fixed, I think we can pass it. Because I don't want to jump into anything. Look at Obamacare, right? We jumped into that, and it's a disaster.
Yeah.
So
okay.
If we could just make sure we know how we're handling it, we handle it properly, and we make sure we get all the gray areas out, I don't see why it can't be legalized.
You know, for me, it's a little different. First of all, I don't smoke anything. I hate the smell, okay?
Right.
But that's not even about, as I said many times, it is not about me or you smoking. It's about the personal freedom that we're supposed to have,
right,
especially when we meet the conditions that we do not endanger others. You know, like right now, for example, I'm sipping a glass of wine. I know I'm not going to be driving. I'm going to be here. And if
right,
I wanted to substitute a bottle of wine, a glass of wine with a plant or some sort of, I don't know, rat poison, it's my business. If I can afford it, I'm not going to make you
exactly
pay for my consequences. So, but it's interesting. You know, as I said, I didn't read through carefully the bill, but I heard from many people that there are a lot of things that they're not still perfect. My only point is between what we have now and something that is an attempt, I don't know. We will see. I hope we're going to find a solution because it's very scary to me the fact that government now has the power to impound and confiscate your property without due process just because they can
right,
find a plant. Not even that you have a lab, a plant by accident could be falling into your garden. And just because that plant is found, they can raid you, SWAT team you, tase you down if you're lucky. And if you make it alive, guess what? Your property is gone without due process. That, for me, something needs to be addressed. So I hate the word even legalization. I would like to say decriminalization of a plant. And there are a lot of money behind,
right,
a lot of lobbies. Private prisons, of course, they love this. They like to keep their business going. And, of course, the police units and everything else love to keep these drugs going as a drug. That's how they make also their money, you know, confiscating people's property without due process. What is your position about private prison? You support them or not?
No, absolutely not. I mean, I think when you have a private prison, you have the problem with, you know, kind of a – what's it called? I'm trying to think of the word and I can't think of. Oh, you have a bit of a conflict of interest, right?
Yeah.
When you have a private prison, it happened out here in Kingman.
Mm-hmm.
You had the private prison out here, and the owner of that was the biggest supporter for Ducey in
mm-hmm.
his campaign, contribution wise.
Mm-hmm.
And so I feel like when you have that, you are now trying to fill beds to make a profit, and so now your crime is going to go through the roof, right? Because all they're going to try to do is influence the law, and they're going to try to arrest more people and get more people convicted to go to prison. And it's the biggest issue that I have with that, the
yeah.
situation.
And this is true,
and,
by the
and
way.
That's why I don't take any money from any private organizations at all.
Mm-hmm.
Because I never want to be in that point where a bill is going through, and they call me and say, hey, Leo, we give you $10,000 for your campaign.
Yeah.
And our bill's going through,
mm-hmm.
you're going to vote yes, right? I mean, that to me is a huge conflict of interest, and I just don't like that part at all about the political game. I mean,
mm-hmm.
I think it should be completely thrown out. I don't think there should be any kind of money going towards campaigns or politicians because that's how the corruption starts in my opinion.
Yes, no, I agree with you completely. I mean, this for me is like just another way. In Italy, you used to call amazzetta. It's like a bribe, okay? I mean, it's a legalized bribe. I don't care how you cut it. Once you can put all that money into a candidate, what do you think? They're going to give it to you just because you're cute? I mean, they want something after, okay?
Right.
Okay, that's the bottom line.
Right.
So anyway, interesting. No, this is true. And I tell you, I'm pretty disgusted by both parties. But recently, you know, at least I can blame most Republicans here because you know, they're doing something that on some issue they're okay. But then when it comes down to special interest, for example, like the private prison, there is no logic. The only logic is
right.
there is no debate. It's their way. And I think it's wrong because one day, as I said, they're going to be responsible for what happens also to the next generation. I mean, one time, you know, we used to have people as a police officer, a peace officer, talking to people, not just arresting them because they forget, for example, to return the book to the library. Okay. Now the levels of arrest is so high. And that is proven that even the machine, you know, to create this sort of a quota system for tickets and fines and everything they can, it is a way that this machine is like a monster. Bigger it gets and more money it wants. And more money means also right. more customers for the private prison system. In Colorado, it's proven the state got sued by the corporation who controls the private prison system because Colorado could not deliver 90% expectancies like they have in contract. So that's right there.
That's ridiculous.
It is demonic, more than ridiculous, demonic. One time, you know, all these politicians that now they think they're part of the good club, that probably, you know, they feel important and nothing's going to happen to them. One day they're going to come back to be regular slaves like us, and they're going to probably have their son and daughters maybe just pulled by a cop or somebody and throw in jail just maybe because they spit on the street. Seriously. So that's right. the reality. We are creating a police state at different levels. And even a state level, I think this is big part of our problems. You know, and I'm glad at least you got this one. You know, as I said, I don't care if we agree or not, but I'm glad at least you're open. You are aware of this reality. Now, let's go back to guns, because we never really talk about guns at all. Yeah. And this is supposed to be the hour about guns. And my listeners say, right. what the heck, Luca, this week you completely skipped the guns. Just tell me, what's going on with the Second Amendment, with Leo Biasiucci? Do you believe in the right of the people to keep and bear arms? Yes or not?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think the biggest thing that scares me about this presidential election is the fact that Hillary Clinton has gone on the record to say, you know, if there's a mass shooting or if there's any kind of, you know, crime involving a gun, you should be able to go after the gun manufacturers. And that to me is probably the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard in my life. I mean, you're pretty much saying if I'm driving a Ford Mustang and I get in a car accident mm-hmm. and it's my fault, I can sue Ford Motor Company because I was in their car.
Yes.
That's ridiculous.
Yes.
I mean, it doesn't make any sense at all. That there makes me extremely, extremely nervous for our country as a whole because, I mean, the right to bear arms is what we stand for. I mean, that's the right given to everybody now. Do I think that people should be having some kind of background check? I mean, that's a really gray area for me because, I mean, do you want somebody who has an extreme mental condition to be owning, you know, 20 guns? I mean, that's a hard part. That's a part that I'm still struggling with. How do you handle that?
We already have laws, by the way, on the book. You know that if you are, for example, domestic violence, you know, convicted, and if you have felonies, and even if you have mental disease. By the way, there's one thing that I really don't like: the fact that now, if you just sign in your FFL document, you know, when you paperwork, when you buy your gun at the shop, and you say that you are, let's say you have marijuana, you know, medical card, they treat you like you're a druggie.
Right.
I mean, seriously, they deny your rights. So there are a lot of things even too much, in my opinion, there. So I don't know.
Right.
I mean,
I
mean, I know, honestly, I think that whatever we have is already too much, and I don't think it's going to fix the problem because the real criminal, the real crazy person, trust me, if he wants to buy that gun, he doesn't need to have 20
guns. He's going
to
get it.
He will
Absolutely.
Get it. You know, that's just
Absolutely.
Another way to control us and to keep track of whatever we need to do and what we are doing. Now, question. In Arizona, you know that we have probably the best gun laws since the last 3 or 4 years. Guns and ammo rated Arizona as the first state for gun rights. And one of the things really I think was the most fundamental in making the difference from all the other states, at least most of them, that here in Arizona, if you are a law-abiding person, you don't need to go to apply for a permit to conceal a weapon. It's called constitutional carry. What do you think about this piece of legislation? Would you vote for that in case you were back to in time to in front of this you know, opportunity to vote, or you will go against?
No, I mean, I think you know, I kind of have the same feeling on that as well. I mean, I think you have the right to have a weapon, whether it's concealed or not. I mean, like you said, it's still, you know, it's still the person behind it that's the problem. It's not the gun itself, right? I mean, I don't think that you should be bringing in more laws to restrict gun owners. You know, I just feel like if you're sitting there and saying, like, you know, you need a permit or whatnot, I mean, I think that's too much control again. I mean, I think that's too much government interaction to get involved with.
Leo, you know, permit means it's not a right. I mean, permit that I need to ask you for your permission. So you can always revoke that permit. So it's like, let's say, privilege. That's what we had, I mean, what they have right now. I'm not there anymore, thank God. In Italy, you don't have rights. You have permits. Everything is a permit. Even if I want to start a magazine, a newspaper, I need a permit from the judge. So that's the reality. There is no First Amendment. There is no Second Amendment. So same story here. Now, question. I know that going around the guns part, I read that you also have an endorsement from an organization, about veterans organization. Tell me more about that.
Right.
Go ahead.
Yeah. No, the Veterans Party is a party that, you know, they kind of have the same mentality as I do. I mean, it's created by vets because, you know, a lot of vets pretty much came together and they said they're kind of tired of the two-party system. And they just feel that, you know, whether you're a vet or not, you can be part of this party because it's not about that, right? It's not about your label anymore. And that's one thing I stand by 100% is, you know, it's about doing what's right. It's about, you know, keeping our rights, right? Keeping our freedoms in check. And the Veterans Party, they are a great group of individuals who firmly believe that we are kind of on a path of losing that, where they believe that, you know, the two-party system has kind of corrupted our country. I mean, it's, you know, there's a lot of hidden agendas, and it's not about doing what's right, and it's not about protecting our freedoms and our rights anymore. And that's why, you know, I'm proud to say that I'm a backed by them, because, you know, they understand it more than anybody. I mean, they're on the front lines. A lot of them, you know, are vets and who saw action in Iraq and Vietnam, and they kind of understand what's going on. I mean, we're not stupid, right? I mean, if you really look at the situations that we're involved in militarily, I mean, we're not doing it for the right reasons.
Leo,
we're not there for
war is a racket.
Reasons.
War is a racket, and I didn't say that.
Right.
General Smedley Butler. Okay, 1920-something, the most decorated four-star general. Okay, it wasn't a hippie. It wasn't some sort of a lefty. And the guy, till then, he said, we are used as hitmen for the bankers.
Right.
That's the reality. Now, out there, also I would like to remember to all the people who call themselves conservatives, Republicans, conservatives, if you really believe in the Constitution, You know better than me, since you were born here probably, guys, that only Congress can declare war. Every time the president or some other, you know, bureaucrat out there, just because they think they got the some sort of a pen and ink to write letters and edicts, can send people to die, and they call these wars, they are no more wars, they are just conflicts, and they are unconstitutional. The last constitutional war declared by Congress that we declared was World War II. After that was just another police, or let's say they use us as a police force, as a, you know, for special interest. We know very well. The point is, if you believe in the Constitution, all these conflicts that we had since Vietnam and Korea, they're all null and void, or at least they're supposed to be never happening. Unfortunately, many people died, gave their life, lost their brothers, lost their sisters. And this is wrong. And this is coming from somebody that, you know,
right,
was even born here. But the reality, what you're saying is true. You know, stop
right.
playing the garbage of McCain, for God's sake, you know, guys out there. You know,
right.
And these people.
Yeah,
you know,
I mean, if we're really in it to do what's right militarily, I mean, why aren't we not in Africa? I mean, you have millions of people who have been killed, raped, pillaged in Africa. And we're not even stepping foot in there. I mean, it's unbelievable. I mean, you look at that whole situation with all the militants, and if we were really doing war for the right reasons, we would have been there a long time ago. But unless we have some kind of interest, I personally believe that we don't get involved, and that's what's wrong with our military complex. I mean, it's become a business.
Yes,
at
it
this
is.
Point.
It is a business. Let me just, you know, unfortunately, we're almost out of time, but, you know, it was an interesting
right.
hour. I'm glad we have a chance to know each other. And more important, thank you for running, because regardless, you know, at least you gave an opportunity to the rest of us to have a third option. You know, I always stuck between Democrats
right.
and Republicans. You know, I like to see at least somebody say, you know what, I may not be perfect, but at least I give you another voice, another option. So please give the way people can contact you, or maybe they can find you on the website. Anyway, you got 60 seconds. Go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, if anybody does want to contact me, you can reach me at my email. That's at Biasiucci, B-I-A-S-I-U-C-C-I, for house. That's spelled out F-O-R, house, and that's at gmail.com. And on Facebook, you can also find me there. Just look for Leo Biasiucci for, you know, the same thing. Leo Biasiucci for Arizona House of Representatives. If you just type that in, you'll find my page. And, you know, it is tough running under third party here in Mojave County. I mean, I was told by another candidate running that I have a 0% chance of winning because I'm not Republican. And, you know, that's the kind of mentality I hope changes here. I mean, I hope that we start to really pick candidates for who they are, pick candidates for what they believe in, because, you know, the definition of insanity is electing the same type of candidate and expecting a different result. And, exactly. And I think we all can agree that where we keep electing the same people and we keep getting frustrated more and more. And it's to me is the reason why I ran as a third party. I mean, I've come across a lot of candidates and politicians who are in office now, and they keep telling me, you know, you need to jump on the Republican side because that's the only way you're going to win.
Leo, I gotta go. We are out of the hour. Listen, yeah, I want I'm to sorry. Thank you very much. Stay there. Don't go away one second. Anyway, listeners, you're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom on KTOX, 1340 AM. Thank you very much. Ready for our number three? Don't tread
on us. Do you want social justice? Now I give you social justice. The Zanna way. Don't trade on us, the Freedom Rifle by Zanna. The most affordable military-grade semi-automatic AR-15 rifle in M4 configuration. Chambered in 223 Wild, they can shoot both 5.56 NATO and 223 Remington. 4 minutes of angle for just $499. Made in the USA. Get your Freedom Rifle now. We need every law-abiding American armed with knowledge and at least one military rifle ready to defend good against evil. With every Don't Tread on Us rifle, you will get free parchment replica of the United States Constitution, free digital CD Don't Tread on Us, free ebook How to Become a Rifleman, free t-shirt Slaves Are Never Armed, I Am Not a Slave, free 30-round magazine Where Allowed by the Law, free laser engraved ejection port, Don't Trade on Us, for just $499. Go to www.freedomrifle.com.
Have you ever met someone on an online dating site and thought, wow, this guy is perfect for me, or she is simply amazing, only to find out they were hiding a deep, dark secret? They plan to vote for Hillary. FreedomLovers.us was created for singles who want to exchange ideas and a love for freedom. People who are looking for solutions to create and defend freedom in the real world, and at the same time, getting that once-in-a-lifetime chance to find their true soulmate. Whether you are interested in meeting your soulmate, making new friends, networking, or hanging out with that like-minded liberty lover, visit freedomlovers.us. It's the first free dating site and community. So, patriots, don't waste your time with other dating sites. Freedomlovers.us is the place where like-minded singles really click.
Here we go, guys and girls. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with luca-zanna on KTOX 1340 AM and on United States the FM Network. Now, this is the final hour, the hour about love. In this hour, normally we talk about different things. We talk about love. We also talk about you. Because I like the idea that this is your show. Yes, I will bring you guests. I will bring you the topics that I think they are important. But at the end of the day, well, you know, I think the most important person, it's your experience. It's sharing your experience, what happened. Of course, we're always talking about topics here that they are related to freedom, to our humanity, and of course to guns. Now, we talked in the past about this New York, or at least in some big cities, type of policy. This is not really, for me, a law. At least it is an unconstitutional law, even if they pass it under the color of law, of stop and frisk. You know, in New York, former mayor Giuliani, he was very proud that stop and frisk somehow curb crimes. You know, my opinion is very simple. You know, we have Bill of Rights. People before us fought and died to give us the basic human rights that every human, in my opinion, should have. And the point is that the Bill of Rights doesn't give us any rights. It reminds the government, enunciate these rights, that they are with us the moment that you were born, okay? And especially the first 10, you know, Bill, the first 10 amendments, from number 1 to number 10, for me, there is no way to compromise them. There is no even debate. They are not for vote, okay? Now, many people lately, unfortunately, because, you know, we're living under the war on terror, that we know, at least I know, and you can say whatever you want, that is being funded by the same people that they're trying to pass the laws to curb and destroy our rights. ISIS, we know, it's a fact, is being funded by the Obama administration. Al-Qaeda was before under the Bush. And all this story keeps going. Now, when they try to tell you that for our security, we must give up some of our rights, I really laugh. And then I get mad. Some idiots out there, they think, oh, if you have nothing to hide, you know, you should submit. You know what? Speak for yourself. I'm not going to submit anything for many reasons. First of all, I took an oath to defend this republic and this constitution. So I'm not going to stay silent when I see somebody peeing on our Bill of Rights. Seriously. If you want to give them up, it's your problem. I don't. The Fourth Amendment spells it out. Government should have that power. Never have that power to start to stop and frisk you just because they feel like it. Maybe just because they don't like your face. Screw you. You need a warrant, you need probable cause. Otherwise, this becomes like Nazi Germany or Italy under Mussolini or many other dictatorship out there. Okay? I don't care which excuse they will bring. We still have that right. Now, I have a caller who's been also a long-time listener, and I appreciate her support. Also be very nice with me, give me gifts for my birthday and everything else, who's calling from the East Coast, a place normally that for me it's kind of another reality. You know, I live in the middle of the boonies here in the Southwest. I don't really see big cities. But, you know, I like to listen from people living in these big cities and to share their experiences, especially when it comes down to stop and frisk. So this is a woman that her name is Cheryl, who wants to share today with us her personal experience about this sort of a stop and frisk. Cheryl, are you there?
I am.
First of all, where are you calling exactly from? Can you remind us?
I'm calling from Pennsylvania.
Okay, Pennsylvania. And, you know, I give you the floor now, and I want you, first of all, I want to ask your opinion. Do you believe that government should have that unchecked power to stop and frisk American people, or people in general, but especially American, we're talking about American people here, American citizens, just because they feel like it, violating our Fourth Amendment? You think that's supposed to be okay, just because now we have to be worried about the people with the turban? By the way, that I believe Muslims, terrorists, yes, their reality, their problem, but government brought them here. That's another story. But anyway, regardless, should we give up our Fourth Amendment?
Well, I think that they should do stop and ask. That's originally what they did. I get to that in my conclusion. Now, maybe it's okay to stop and ask you, but I don't think they should do the frisk part. Mm-hmm. But that was in my conclusion, so I'll get to that.
Okay.
Anyway.
I mean, stop and ask means, you know, yes, I can even give you my Fifth Amendment, so you can ask all you want. Thank you very much, officer. I don't want to talk to you. Okay? I mean, that's fine. Talk is free, okay? But you don't start to ask me for an ID if there is no probable cause, you know, because this is not like paper, please. I mean, you know, if you start to ask, you know, first of all, there are Supreme Court cases that you cannot just ask paper to people just because you feel like it. Should be some sort of a probable cause. But regardless, they can ask. That's fine. Have a wonderful day. Am I free to go? That would be my answer. But beside that, now, you know, in New York was the law of the land, or at least the city ordinance, under Mayor Giuliani, that the police can stop and ask you documents and frisk you, even if you have done nothing, even if they have not any type of, let's say, constitutional legitimacy to do that type of legal action against you. So do you believe that would be good just to start to say, show me your papers, and if we don't like your attitude, now bend over, and we're going to start to frisk your ass. What do you think?
Well, in my story, that's what I was going to say, all that, how exactly what they did.
Okay, go ahead.
All right. My story is I was stopped and frisked, and much more, in North Philadelphia. Now, when people say, no, Philadelphia, what were you doing there? Well, that's my story, how it happened. And that was the night my Fourth Amendment was shredded completely. I mean, when you got two officers that have guns there, you do what they say. So at any rate, I was living and working in Philadelphia at the time. I was working during the day in Kensington at Episcopal Hospital Society of Technologists. And when I was done, I went several blocks west of Kensington, and I was in North Philadelphia. I worked at a clinic called Maria de los Santos. It was a part of Philadelphia Health Services. I had helped them start their cytology lab, and I was their cytotechnologist. So the one night, the cleaning lady came in, and she looked like she had been crying. I was sitting there at the scope screen, pap smears. And I asked her what was wrong. Why was she crying? And she said, will you help me? Can you do me a favor? And I said, well, that depends on what it is. She said, well, my car's in the shop. Somebody brought me here, but I have no way to get home. And I said, well, what about the person who brought you? They can't. Well, did you ask anybody else here? Everybody said no. She said, you're my last hope. And I said, oh, boy. I said, you want me to take you home in North Philly at night? And I said, that's dangerous. I said, after I drop you off, I'll be alone in the car. And if my car breaks down or I get lost, I'm alone in that car. I said, I don't think I could do that. And then she started to cry, and I just stared at her, and I said, I know I'm going to regret this, but I said, I'll do it. So after work, we went out to the parking lot, and she said, I want you to make sure every one of your windows is up tightly, and I want every door locked, and I had a four-door. And I said, oh, where is she taking me? So I got into the car, and I started driving to her house. And about a few blocks before her house, she said, I have something to tell you. I said, okay. She said, when I get out, make sure you relock this door. And I said, fine. And she said, also, when you come to the stop sign, nobody stays long at the stop signs around here. So she said, if you do, there's a lot of drug dealers here, and they will come and break your window and attack you.
I mean, where are you going? Are you going to Iraq? This is like America. I mean, what is that? North Philadelphia?
North Philadelphia,
oh my God.
Yeah.
You need to double insurance.
I said, oh, wow. I was regretting I had even done this. I said, wonderful. She got out. I locked the door, and I continued to the stop sign, and there was nobody. There was no cars. There was not one person there. There was no drug dealers. And I sat there and I said, I wonder how long I have to sit here when there's no traffic and it's dark. There was nobody had a light on. And so I stayed there as long as I thought was okay, legal. I started pulling out, and all of a sudden there was a police car behind me, siren going, light flashing. I said, oh, he mustn't have thought I waited long enough. Now I'm going to get a ticket. So I pulled over. He pulled over behind me. He comes up to my window, and instead of saying anything about the stop sign, he said, where the hell have you been and where are you going? I was in shock. And I said, well, officer, I just got off of work at Maria de los Santos, and I just dropped off a coworker whose car is in the shop, and now I'm going home. And if I don't live in this neighborhood, and I said, I am tired. I work two jobs. I want to go home. He looked over at the lab jacket, and he pointed, and he said, who does that belong to? And I said, me. I just told you I work two jobs. The first one is at a hospital, and they require I wear a lab jacket. I'm taking it home to clean it. And then he asked for my IDs. You wouldn't have been proud of me, Luca. I handed them to him. He asked for my license and my insurance and my registration and all that, so I gave it to him.
But can I ask you something? What is... When they stop you, What was exactly the cause, the probable cause? Why stop you?
Well, that's what I'm getting at.
Okay, go ahead.
I thought it was a stop sign, but in the end, it wasn't. That's what the rest of the story is about. So at any rate, I gave him everything, and then he handed it back to me. I thought, well, he's going to give me a warning and let me go. And I no sooner got my IDs in my wallet, and his voice changed. He yelled at me, get out of the car. And I said, what? Get out of the car now. You heard me.
Wow.
I thought, what did I do now? So I got out of the car, and I'm standing there, and he screamed at me, spread your legs. And I said, excuse me, what? Spread your legs. And I said, and this guy looked like Kojak with scars all over his face. And I said, oh, if that creep touches me, I'll scream. And he did. He came over towards me. And I'm telling you, Luca, he touched every part of my body.
Really?
I don't know if he was feeling for drugs or a gun.
Okay, listen, one second. Let me ask you more details here. This is the part that comes interesting. First of all, you had any witness with you?
No, I didn't have a witness with me, but there was another police officer there.
Oh, so there was another police officer. What he was doing,
yes.
This police officer, he was okay, he was watching. Or maybe he was saying something to the officer. Maybe he said, hey, calm down. Maybe you're just really...
Well, eventually, that officer never talked. Mm. But he did eventually tell him to watch me. But at any rate,
wow.
I don't know why I'm getting an echo.
Yeah, that's weird. By the way, when he started to touch you, did he touch your underwear or under the underwear? Where did he go?
No, he went down there, but he touched all those private areas.
Really?
I didn't. Really, yes. I guess, you know, maybe he thought I was hiding drugs in my bra and in my underwear. I don't know.
So he went to your underwear. Did he touch your skin?
He touched everything.
This is like a... By the way,
he made me take my shoes off.
I'm not an expert, but I know what I know. Normally for this type of invasive, let's say, procedure, a female officer should be called, not a man, number one. Number two, you know, if I do that, if any guy out there touches any part of the skin of a woman, okay, if you go, becomes a felony right there, okay? That's sexual assault.
We lost that battle. That's at the end of what I was going to tell you about that.
Okay, go ahead. But, just, I shut up.
But
go
at
ahead.
Any rate.
My God.
At any rate, after he was done, I was thinking thoughts like, you pervert, I want to slap you across the face. I want to kick you where it hurts. This is the way you get to feel a woman, to do this kind of stuff. I mean, then after he was done, he stood up and he said, he screamed at me again. He was yelling, and it was making me very nervous. He said, walk a straight line. And I thought, with him yelling at me and I'm tired, watch me not be able to walk that straight line and go to jail. So I did it, and then he yelled, that's enough, stop, turn around. So I did. And then he said, where are your keys? I said, in the ignition. So then he went and got my keys. He turned around to the other police officer who was standing there, who was black. And he was, like, in shock, total shock. His mouth was open. His eyes looked like they were going to pop out of their sockets. I mean, he was just really shocked. And he said to him, watch her. She doesn't get away. He went around my car to the front passenger side, opened it up, and took that lab jacket and started looking through it.
Wow.
So, I mean, there was just pens, dotting pens and writing pens in it. But then he looked at the ID. That's where he got me. It said laboratory.
Wow.
And, I mean, no, we do not deal with drugs in cytology. The closest we even come to a drug, and if you want to consider it, that is ethyl alcohol for staining. And it is drinkable, but I didn't have any with me. I could have used it at that point, but we didn't have any.
Yeah, my point, he doesn't know anything about that. He has no right to do what he did to you. Yeah, then he had no warrant from a judge. He had no probable cause. He just was there. And, you know, I'm no lawyer. I'm not a man of law. But I tell you, from outside, he broke probably more than two or three laws out there. I mean, the point is, they can do these things because they see probably a woman by herself in the middle of the night. And this is really sad, happening in America, things like that.
It gets worse. It gets worse.
Worse.
So he throws the lab jacket down. He opens up my compartment. He throws everything on the seat and starts going through it. Things like, I had things like a map and some manuals from the car and a flashlight and maybe some napkins and pens and stuff in there. And he didn't find any drugs, so we threw it back in there, and he started going, putting his hands down in my seat, seeing if there was anything stuck down there. And then he took a flashlight and went down under my seat to see if there was anything under there, which there wasn't, and he slammed the door, and he opened up the back, and he did the same thing there with the seat and down on the floor. So he didn't find anything there. So the last thing was my trunk. And anything in my trunk, my father had put in there. I hardly ever went in it. And there was no way he put drugs in there. So anyways, he opened up the trunk, and there was a spare tire. He threw everything on the ground. There was a spare tire. There was things like a jack, tools, window washer fluid, the wiper fluid. There was maybe extra oil and antifreeze, that kind of stuff. So he didn't find anything. He threw that in there, and he slammed down the trunk. And then he comes around to me, and he hands me the key, and I thought, well, maybe he's going to be nice and apologize. He didn't find anything. Instead, he says, you get the hell out of here, and don't you ever come back.
Like what? Is that his own private property? I mean, who is God telling you that? I mean, this is a cop, right? This is exactly Philadelphia Police Department. What is that? How do they call themselves? What is their name?
Narc. He was a narc. That's what I found out.
Who was that?
There's a difference. He was a narc.
A narc.
They specialize in narcotics.
Oh, the worst then, really. I mean, my opinion,
yeah,
these are the worst.
They're trained to be like this. And those scars on his face, he probably was in a lot of fights in that neighborhood.
I'm sure he didn't get beat up enough, in my opinion, because this piece of crap, you know, he still have a badge, he still has some rules, he still has some... He took an oath to defend the Constitution himself and the state Constitution, and he acted like a pure... thug. That's what he did, in my opinion, for what you're telling me from here, okay? Of course, I wasn't
when
there.
I got him, I did call his place that he worked, his station, his department.
Uh-huh.
And I got to speak to his boss, and they got him on. I don't know if he was a captain or who was on there, but he claimed he was over him. And I told him my story, and he said he was an ARC. And he said, did he give you a ticket? And I said, no. And believe it or not, Luca, this is what he said to me.
What?
Then why the hell did you bother me? Why did you call me? Just shut the hell up. And he slammed the phone.
Wow. So, you know, the fact that pretty much he committed a felony on you, if it was any other person touching your skin, your private part, as a woman without your consent, that would be a felony, okay? Sexual assault, at least. But the fact that they can do that just because they're bored or they feel like it, and that's not good enough. I mean, the ticket is nothing. The ticket is the tip of the iceberg. In my opinion, what he did to you is much worse than a ticket for your dignity as a woman. I mean, if that was my mom or my sister or my wife or my girlfriend, I would go nuts. You know, forget about the ticket.
I felt so violated.
Yeah.
I really did. So when I got off the phone with that man, I said, that's it. I'm going to sue the Philadelphia Police Department. I'm going to sue the city. Now, I'm going to write a big letter to the Philadelphia Inquirer.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I settled down, I said, well, you know, he was a narc. He did tell me he's trained to be like that.
Wow.
So
that's straight.
I thought, well, not all police are like that, so I'm just going to let it go. Yeah. I might need a policeman someday when these bad neighborhoods I go into. So the next day, I saw that lady I had taken home. She was Puerto Rican, and the neighborhood was black and Puerto Rican. So I really stood out. So at any rate, I told her what had happened, and she said, I'm sorry. I said, no, you've got to understand, I can never do this again. If I go back into your neighborhood, he will arrest me.
Wow.
I said, what you have to do is if your car is in the shop and you can't get a ride to work and home, you have to call in work and say, I can't come in today, my car is broke. But that's my story, what happened. Now, I have some things I looked up, and you can make comments on that. There was a lawyer on YouTube who was given advice. If you're ever stopped, the first thing you're supposed to do, which is what I should have done, is you're supposed to ask, officer, why am I being stopped? What did I do wrong? The second thing you're supposed to, he said, you do not have to give your IDs, which you said. He said, you do not have to, and you can ask the officer, give me your name, and I'll give you my IDs. I think that would cause a lot of confrontations.
Yeah, especially if you have no witnesses, they shoot you first, and then they ask you questions later, especially when you're by yourself and no video camera. One thing I want to say to everybody, you know, it is very important. And I don't want to put down every cop, because I know there are decent human beings out there. Beings try to do their job. But unfortunately, the statistics now start to come out more and more. What you're saying here, it's coming out more and more I think it's something changed. Corruption has always happened, okay? Humanity, every human being is corruptible. So when you have a position of power, unfortunately, it's easy for a human being to become weaker and to use that extra power and abuse it. And I'm not saying every cop is bad, but I tell you, recently, the last few years, reading the news and watching videos, especially now with the technology that we have, we can watch as the first eyewitnesses. I was watching right now a video while we were talking about two or three guys. They've been pulled over by a cop, and they all immediately stopped the car and they put themselves on their knees. And this guy, well, just because he turned his head for a moment, he was kicked in the face against the car. It was ridiculous. And that was on video, the same video from the police car. So I tell you, I think there is something going on that comes from the top, because the new type of training that they receive, they also, I believe, that the type of recruiting is being proven that if you are too smart, they may not even want you. And there was a lawsuit of a police officer, or at least a guy who was trying to become a police officer, who passed the test, and he was a very smart guy, and he proved that they were hiring people that were much dumber than he was. And the judge said, that's the way it is. My point is, there is something terribly wrong that's happening. And I'm very sad to hear that, because this is supposed to be America. And now you realize that they're doing that more and more. And every time they pick their prey, they know that normally the average person does two jobs, does have enough money and resources to fight back, and they take advantage of that. And who has really the money to go to?
Well, Luca.
Yeah.
I have two more things that lawyer said that will get you out of, no matter what.
Tell me. Go ahead. Go ahead, please.
He said, first of all, when you're sitting there and he didn't give you a ticket, like in my case, you're supposed to ask, am I being detained or am I free to go?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Am I being detained or am I free to go? You're supposed to keep saying that. And if he says you're being detained, say why and on what grounds.
Exactly.
The last thing, and this is very important, everybody should remember this, whenever he wants to do any kind of searches, you say, officer, I just want you to know, I do not consent to searches.
Yes.
He said he'll be floored because it's a legal term when you say that sentence.
Yes.
I do not consent to searches.
Yes. Well, at least,
I have some info on stop and searches. It first started around 1964-65.
Mm-hmm.
Before that, it was called stop and ask.
Yeah.
New York uses stop and frisk more than any other big city.
Yeah.
Next to New York is Philadelphia, then Boston, and then Baltimore. Another name for stop and frisk is the Terry stop.
Wow.
Only 0.2%, Luca, only 0.2% of all the stops and frisks have had guns.
My gosh.
Okay, keep that in mind. 50% of the stops and frisks are between 14 years of age and 24. 14 to 24. So they're very young.
That is
the
so
use
sad.
Of stop and frisk peaked in 2011. From when it started to 2011, it kept going up in the thousands and then started coming down. And now, the thing about Trump and Hillary when they were talking about, is it constitutional? This is the ruling. I actually looked it up.
Mm-hmm.
In 2013, it was ruled in the court of law that it is not unconstitutional. It is not unconstitutional, but the way it was being practiced was.
Okay.
So that's where the confusion is.
Well, let me, you know, they can say, lawyers and judges can say that the sky is pink and the, you know, an elephant is flying. You know, I tell you something. This is, for me, to a point that we are coming so much, giving so much power even to read the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. That was written in such an easy language. It was so simple and also so short. You know, it's not like Obamacare, 2 million pages. This is something very simple. If an immigrant like myself can read it, okay? The right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrants shall issue but upon probable cause supported by oath or affirmation, blah, blah, blah. So my point is, right now, all these officers, police officer, whatever they want to call themselves, they took an oath in front of God, in front of the American people. They put their hand probably on the Bible and on the Constitution, or at least they raised their hand. And this is part of what they're supposed to defend. So all this story, you know, they're here to defend us and keep us safe. That's a bunch of crap. These people, unfortunately, they're being brainwashed to enforce the new police state in America for them, against the American people. And I feel sorry for them, because one day, when they realize what they've done to us, they will be too late, because this crime will be perpetrated, and it will apply also to their sons and daughters. And they have created this new complete tyranny that all the new generation will be subjected to. And it's up to us now to stop it. And the first way how we stop it, we talk about it and stop defending everybody just because has a uniform and a badge. Not because you have a badge, you have my respect. You earn the respect. You show that you're a good person. You show that you defend the Constitution and you're a peace officer. You are not a master or some sort of enforcer. Okay, that's the first thing.
Now, I have the stop and frisk data from New York, and it goes from 2002 to 2016, but I'm only going to read the one for three of them.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
And in 2002, when they started taking this data down, there were 97,296 stops and frisks. And of those, 82% were totally innocent. Now, in 2011, which is the peak, I picked that one because it was the peak, in New York City it went up to 685,724 stops and frisks. Of those, 88% were totally innocent, or 605,328. Totally innocent people. 53% were black, 34% were Latino, and 9% were white. Now, you could say from those statistics that maybe there's racial profiling going on, or you could turn it around and say, well, maybe they do more crime than whites. But, I mean,
so far,
that's what it was for 2011.
Yeah. Anyway, that's
now
also...
Now I have something for ladies. You'll want to hear that one.
Go ahead, please. Go ahead.
I want to hear you. They rounded 2011 off to 700,000 stops and frisks. And they said of that, 46,784 women were stopped in New York City.
Wow.
16,000 were frisked. Of those, only 59 guns turned up.
Yeah.
And that put the rate of – you're going to love this one – that puts the rate of finding a firearm at 0.13% for women compared to 0.12% for men, which resulted in 3,993 arrests.
You know,
and it said that most of these stops and frisks ended most often in low-level weed charges or marijuana. And the last thing that says on there is that the complication for this is that women don't want to be frisked by a male officer, that they're demanding they want a woman officer to be there or do it. And it said, ladies, you lost your case. It's legal for a male officer to do it.
I don't want to be frisked, period, okay? I don't want to frisk, period. Just because I'm walking on the street, you know, I don't want to be talking to you unless you have probable cause that I committed a crime. That's the bottom line.
Well, I didn't do anything but take anybody home.
I know. My point is, it's insane. I tell you, you know, why you think, seriously, I'm coming to a realization that I could never go to one of these big cities. because it is so completely another world. It almost seems like we have two Americas. Don't get me wrong. They do crap even here in Arizona. Sometimes they do their same type of things. They try to do the same things. But there is a little different type of, let's say, society. First of all, you know, here it's our right to be armed. Okay? We don't even need to have a permit. And don't push too much tyranny on our face, because American people here in Arizona, or at least Arizona people, you know, there is a point that if you assault somebody, if you touch, you know, without probable cause, a sexual assault, a woman, or even a man, you may never know who you're going to find there. Okay, so I think there is much more responsibility and more respect here, in some reason, in this rural part of America, at least. But I tell you, I know for sure, I wouldn't last 5 minutes if I come to any of these big cities like New York or whatever, Pennsylvania or Philadelphia. You know, I know it's not good, because I wouldn't last 5 minutes. I would say, no, I don't want to be touched by you. And at that point, they will shoot me. And I'm sure about that. So I say, you know, I'm glad, at least for you, that ended there. But it's sad to think that this part of America right now, it is nothing anymore that's supposed to be. What we used to have, or what we're supposed to have. You know, probably we lost a long time ago in some of these big cities. But, you know, people, please don't start to think this is the normality. I mean, read our Constitution, read our Bill of Rights. If I can tell you, I'm able to read it. And, you know, you don't need to be a lawyer. Look, I can't even speak English correctly, but I can read it. I say it again, the Fourth Amendment, okay, the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, okay? That's the point. So now you people, especially the conservative people that they think they are, you know, the good old boys, Republicans, and you think you are for the Constitution, how can you, you know, believe that this is okay? Just because you have this sort of, idea that you have nothing to hide, you should be pretty much let have your daughter or your wife or even yourself be completely be humiliated. Remember, people before us, our founding fathers fought and died to be sure that we had these basic human rights in our Bill of Rights. Don't give them away, at least without a fight, for God's sake. You know, shame on you if you give up. But anyway, I want to thank you.
Anyways, I want to finish up.
Please, go ahead. Finish up. Go ahead.
In 2016, from January to June, the New Yorkers that were stopped and frisked went way down to 7,636.
Whoopie-doo.
77% were totally innocent, or 5,843. 53% were still black, 30% Latino, but weights went up to 11%.
Okay.
And then I have my conclusion. I was not stopped for anything to do with the stop sign. I was stopped because I was blonde-haired, mm-hmm. white skin, and a woman.
Yeah.
And they do claim that drug dealers use
Women
such as me.
You know, now, let me tell you my reason. I think he was a horny bastard, and he wanted to have a little fun. And he said, you know what, let's have a little fun. Let's show his boss here. That's, I really believe that. It has nothing to do with the conspiracy that blonde women, they're potentially, you know, drug dealers. That's pure BS. I think he found a single woman, probably attractive there, driving around with no witnesses. Guess what? You know, unfortunately, some of these people, the typical bullies that the high school, they couldn't have a girlfriend, and they had to go find behind the badge the little power to feel a man. That's what I really believe. Maybe just I'm wrong, but I don't think so. You know, there is no excuse.
At the time, I just thought maybe it was because the hour I was there, and because of what I just said about my white skin, blonde hair, and what was I doing there, because it was a black and Puerto Rican neighborhood.
And so what?
And
I mean,
I thought maybe he thought, especially when he saw the lab jacket, that I was dealing in drugs. And I did read one article that the best way to get stopped and frisked is to be a minority, a friend of a minority, or date or married to one. And I guess I was like a friend of a minority because I took her home.
I say the best way to fight it back is to have witnesses, video cameras, and sue the bastards. That's what I think I say, in my opinion. Because I tell you, this is, if you had some witnesses, if you had a video camera, if you had a couple extra bucks to show him that you are not just here giving up, you know, maybe you have a good lawyer that would take the case and start to sue the old departments, to sue her, the bastard there, and also the city, they will start to change attitude a little bit. Unfortunately, you know, people, they are, you know, try to work for a living and they don't have the resources. And, you know, they don't have maybe, you know, you go by yourself. You don't have witnesses. Now I say everybody buy some of these video cameras, especially micro cameras. They are affordable. Video pen, because at the end of the day, this is about the truth. This is not about fabricating anything. The video camera, it is there, is it pretty much says the truth. And that's what we need. Nothing but the truth. Listen, I want to say thank you, and I'm glad that you made
it. I wanted to say that I am a Trump supporter, but when he said that there's merit to stop and frisk, I thought, well, if it saves a police officer's life, because I did later let this incident, just forget it, and I did actually join a police organization, and I found a lot of nice men and women in there.
Yeah.
I was mixed up with my feelings, because I had been stopped and frisked, and if it stops crime and it saves an officer's life, can understand it.
No, I don't understand.
Gave you data, but no. Luca, I just gave you data of all those innocent people that were stopped and frisked.
You know
like
what?
Me.
They always say...
Maybe they should go back to stop and ask.
You know, say you ask only when you have probable cause. If you want to ask, you ask politely, and I will tell you politely if I want to talk with you or not. That's my attitude. And I don't buy this stuff, oh, just to save one life, we have to give up all our rights. Because the same argument, the anti-gun crowd, they say we must give up all our guns because we must save one child. Even if it's just one child, that's pure BS. That's pure propaganda from the tyrants out there. No, I don't buy that. We have a system that's based on a constitution, a bill of rights. And that's why we should comply, and especially them, because the Constitution is to constrain the government. It doesn't give us any rights. Same story for the Bill of Rights. It's to remind the government that we have rights. Okay? So these people, that they're completely, you know, completely breaking any type of laws and not. Shame on them. Shame on them. I don't know how you can go back to sleep at night when you know what you're doing, because one day it's going to be your son, it's going to be your daughter facing the same tyranny that you are pretty much submitting ourselves, or try to submit ourselves. Anyway, listen, as I said...
They're stopping women more and more now.
Yeah, it's going to be one day, it's going to be his wife, it's going to be his daughter, okay? That's the truth. Listen, I got to go, I got another person to bring in, but I want to thank you for you sharing your experience, as much as it's a bad experience, but at least, you know, you're here, you're talking. Sometimes people don't even have the chance to be alive after these experiences. They get shot just because they don't bow down fast enough. I'm sorry. This is the truth. Lisa, thank you very much, okay? And I appreciate your input, and thank you for the call.
Okay.
Thank you. That was Cheryl from Pennsylvania. And I really do, you know, I said, I don't want to generalize. I know there are good cops out there, okay? I mean, my grandfather was a cop, okay? In Italy, from my father's side. And I tell you, I know what it means. You have a lot of stress. You're going to face a tough world out there. Normally, you deal with criminals. But this is exactly why you need to be above the average. You cannot just start to treat everybody as a criminal. That's why you need to be a professional peace officer, in my opinion. And that's why, especially in America, because in Italy, we don't have that. We have a Bill of Rights. We have a very interesting constitution that is different from every other piece of the constitution from around the world. And that's why, you know, the moment that you take an oath to become a peace officer, the first job you have to do, in my opinion, is to defend the constitution, to defend those rights, to keep the peace. That's what I really believe would be important. And, you know, I would like to more and more say, you know, let's bring the good cops out. And let's try to point out the people that they are completely, you know, giving a bad name to the badges and to the uniform. Unfortunately, lately, I believe this is part of a federal program. And the top, you know, normally they say that the fruit doesn't fall too far from the tree. Normally the different, you know, leadership out there who does also the recruits, that's their responsibility to try to train properly our peace officers. And by the way, now they call them law enforcement. It's no more. But we'll talk about that next time. Okay, little break. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with luca-zanna, final hour. Don't go away.
Hey, you. Yes, I'm talking to you. You deserve a break. Enjoy a moment of indulgence. It's time for Zanna Coffee. Guilt-free pleasure. Zanna Coffee is the organic coffee to amplify your senses and enhance love for life.
liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Only the best organic and GMO-free coffee beans from around the world that I selected. Zanna Coffee brings you happiness in every cup. Fair trade certified, sustainable organic coffee. That means we do not use slaves. Free Zanna songs with every coffee bag. Find Zanna Coffee at www.zannacoffee.com. www.zannacoffee.com. Get your coffee bag now. Don't be cheap. Life is too short and you deserve the best. Zanna Coffee. Okay, we are back in the studio. We are back here on the air with Luca Zanna. You're listening to Love, Guns and Freedom on KTOX 1340 AM. One thing really stresses me out every year, there is always the same time, pretty much. It is this sort of racket money called property taxes, you know. Let me tell you something. Think about it. During the Middle Ages, you as a slave or as a subject, you had to pay your property taxes to the king. That was a fact. Black and white. You are a subject, is the king. You got to pay king's land or whatever you have. Now, the point is here, things didn't change much. But there are, of course, moments that we had it better, and then we started to lose it, especially in America. I realize in Europe, never really changed. Since the time of the Romans, you know, slaves always been paid pretty much taxes. Even citizens been paying their taxes, because there's always been a way to, especially during the empire, that you need to feed the machine. There's never been really free humanity, okay? Of course, during the time of the popes and kings, you can imagine. And then, of course, that's pretty much the story, history of Europe. America had it good for a while. You know, our founding fathers say, you know what? We don't want any more kings and lords. And once your property is yours, supposed to be yours. If there is a tax, you pay once. But if you pay every year, let's say this sort of property taxes, you don't really own the thing. It is just some sort of a lease that you have, like a rental, towards the government. Maybe before there was, of course, not before, it was towards the king. So anyway, this country never really stopped me. Since the beginning of this country, we'd never really had property taxes like we have today, especially since the creation of this public, let's say, school system. Now, I would like to start to think, and more important, put some thoughts out with the same concept that government can make you pay every year a tax. Just because you're supposed to own that property, in case the house, it could be also a piece of land, they can also at that point say you can also have to pay the tax on the property that you have inside the house, like, for example, your couch, your television. And I was almost kidding about that because this is kind of ridiculous. I mean, for me, it's even ridiculous the fact I'm supposed to pay property tax, but that's, we know the story. If you don't pay, your property is gone. So that's the point, the reality that we are not free, the reality that pretty much we are already a communist nation. This is pure communism 101, but technically socialist, because they get their power through votes. Communists get their powers through the barrel of a gun. So it's a little more sophisticated, a little more legalized, but the reality is the same. You don't pay your property taxes, your history. Now, I found an interesting guy that I really like him. You know, I said, you know, on the air, I want people that we disagree, we are more than welcome. But when I go on Facebook, I'm kind of selective, and I like like-minded people. Doesn't mean that we need to agree on everything, but we have the basic down, okay? So I really an interesting guy that also has an interesting last name. His name is Tony Quattro. That means four breads. And let me just bring him in. And Tony, are you there?
I am here, Luca.
Nice to meet you, Tony. I would like to give you the floor. But first of all, tell me exactly where you are from and where you were from.
Right now, I live in Tucson, Arizona. Originally, I am from Connecticut.
Okay. And before that, you have an interesting last name. And by the way, you know the translation of your last name, right? Are you aware of it?
Yes, I do. Uh-huh.
is like four breads. That's interesting. I've always been fascinated about the last names. You know, my last name is Zanna, means like the fang of the animal. Okay, some kind of a wild beast out there. I don't know what was my great great grandfather. Maybe some sort of one tooth man. But anyway, and you have, you know, maybe your family was into the bread business. Who knows? Quattro pani. That's interesting. I'm really interested about that. When did who came to the new country here? Was your grandfather or great grandfather? Do you know the story about your family?
Yes, I do. It was my grandparents. Okay. They came from Italy.
Oh, wow. So that's kind of still close time, you know, like you are second generation here, correct?
Yes, I am.
Very good. All right, listen, you got a very interesting experience that I don't invite you, but you were living in Connecticut, correct?
That is correct.
Tell us a little bit, because, you know, here in Arizona, I'm complaining just the fact that I had to pay property taxes on the land or on my home. That's already something I hate it. But and that make me feel sick every time. But tell us a little bit more about, to feel better, how bad things are in Connecticut. At least how bad were when you were there. Maybe now they got worse. I don't know. Go ahead.
They're much worse now.
Wow.
I was there. I left in 1997 and eventually made my way to Arizona in 1999. But while I was there, the tax assessor would come around to your property every so many years and check the condition of your house and find things in your home to purposely raise your property taxes.
Wow.
So if you had built a shed in the backyard that was a certain size, it could raise your property taxes. Okay. If you had put in new windows in your home, they could raise property taxes.
Oh my God.
If you had new cabinetry or you redid the basement and made it a living space, anything that you did to your home, they wanted to come in and see so they could raise property taxes.
Question, they can come pretty much as their pleasure, or they have to have a warrant? I'm just curious.
No, they did not have a warrant. They would just basically show up one day and knock on your door to see if anybody was home.
Wow.
And most people would let them in. They're of the mindset that it was okay. Wow. You let the tax guy in. I don't remember anyone ever saying no or complaining.
You know, listen, you know, I wasn't there and you were either, but if I can visualize history during our founding fathers, we had to face, you know, quartering of troops in their own homes and the king's soldiers, you know, being free to go everywhere they wanted just because they're king's soldiers, okay? I mean, I don't see much difference since then till the time that you were in Connecticut. Am I right or wrong? Am I too extreme about it?
No, I think you're completely right about that, Luca.
I mean,
yeah, and it's become acceptable, and it's not supposed to be acceptable.
I mean, the basic are the basic. We were talking today before, just a few minutes ago, with this lady from Pennsylvania about this stop and frisk, you know, that the last few years, not just today, but the last 20, 30 years in the East Coast, in the big cities, the police departments, they think they have the authority to pretty much pee over the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, in this case, the Fourth Amendment, and just because they feel like it, they can stop you, ask you questions. As I say, you know, you can ask me questions, that's fine. I don't need to answer to you. But when you start to put your hands on me without any type of probable cause or warrant, we have a problem, in my opinion. So right now I see the same trend in Connecticut, also when it comes down to your residence, to your home. I mean, the Fourth Amendment doesn't really exist anymore, maybe never really existed in that part of the Union. I mean, when did it happen that you remember?
Oh, when did it happen in Connecticut when they started coming into your house?
Yeah, maybe since the time of the kings, never really left. I mean, what happened there? It's very amazing.
Well, yeah, I don't really know when it started. I mean, I remember it my whole life living there.
Wow.
My grandfather, he was the head state tax examiner of the state of Connecticut.
Wow.
And he was completely indoctrinated into the system. He believed it was okay, too.
Wow. This is sad. You know, sad because sometimes we don't, I think, you know, as you said, we are brainwashed, you know, and we think that's normal. This country, you know, and I tell you because I was born in another part of the world and I see the difference, at least on paper, what supposed to be, what used to be, and what is still in Europe. You know, in Europe, things never really changed in time of kings and lords. We never had a Bill of Rights. We never had the First Amendment, Second Amendment, Third Amendment, Fourth Amendment. Here, somebody before us fought and died and bled to give us something that all we had to do was to preserve it. We didn't have to go to fight after them. They already fought the battles. They already fought the war. And we just would be here and at least be standing up and say, no, this is what we need to preserve. And look what happened. I mean, it breaks my heart. Breaks my heart very much, I'm telling you. So at least all I know that, though, one thing we must do, in my opinion, at least we should do. I don't want to say must. I don't speak for others. We should at least start to have one moment of thinking and stop just going with the flow, using our own brain, and start to say, are we really free? How can you call yourself free when you have to pay the rent every year to, at this point, no more the king, but the state, in this case, that, you know, they can pretty much put you out of your home. If you are, for example, on fixed income, and I know many people on fixed income, like on retirement, if the property taxes start to go up every year, and your, you know, pension doesn't go up, you eventually have to make a choice between having dinner or paying your taxes. And that's how they can take your property. Am I right or wrong? I mean, don't you think that can happen?
No, you're completely right about that. There's one more thing I'd like to add.
Please, go ahead.
When I was living in Connecticut, a lot of times what the state would do is go to these families that had lived on their property in their houses. The family had been there for over 200 years since mm-hmm. the founding of this country.
Wow.
And they would take them, that family, out of their house because they couldn't afford to pay for property taxes.
Wow.
And then the pay would put them in subsidized housing and pay for it, take their land, take their property and sell it and take the money.
Like animals. I mean, really, like domesticated animals. You know, this is so sad.
It's theft.
No, it is theft. And that's why I really believe we need to look into this. And people say, oh, this is for the children. First of all, wait a second. If you call yourself out there, let's say a constitutional, a conservative, somebody who believes that the Constitution is the rule of the land, the law of the land, okay? Wait a second. We're never supposed to be a socialist country because this is pure socialism 101. If you complain about Obamacare, you should have complained about property taxes long time ago. People can say, how can we do for the education? Fine. I believe in charity. I believe in many other things. The point that coercion is coercion. I don't care if it's for the good cause or not. That's the reality because, you know, even a thief can say, you know, I'm stealing this money because, after all, I want to give them to somebody for a good purpose. It's still theft. When they get your money without your consent, I don't care who's taking it, it's still a theft. It's still an extortion. I have more respect for the mafia, at least, you know, that's the mafia. You can shoot back, at least, okay? And if you're lucky, maybe you may win the gunfight. But with the government, no. It's a mafia with absolute powers. That's my humble opinion, of course. I'm not speaking for yourself. I'm responsible for my words. So listen, I want to say, first of all, thank you for even sharing this terrible experience that our brothers and sisters are facing in Connecticut. And I want to give you the floor to close. Whatever you want to say, you know, you got the floor. This is your microphone now.
Okay, well, thank you, Luca. Just two quick points. One, people need to start thinking, and we need to stop going with the herd mentality, and we need to say enough's enough, and we need to draw the line in the sand, and we need to go back to get our freedoms. Secondly, I want to thank you personally, Luca, for you standing up, putting yourself out there, and changing the social consciousness to bring awareness to the people about, hey, we need our freedoms back. We need to keep these freedoms. We need to preserve them, just like you said. And enough is enough. So I really want to thank you for what you're doing.
Oh, thank you very much. Maybe one day I'd like to meet you, seriously. No, by the way, I will be in at a gun show in Phoenix in December. I don't know if you ever go to the gun show, but I want to start to put it out there for all my listeners. If you are in Phoenix area or southern Arizona, I'll be there, God's willing. Exactly, it's going to be the Phoenix, the December the 2nd, the 3rd, and the 4th. I will bring the Freedom Rifle. I will bring smoke grenades. I will bring music. I will bring even coffee and my hugs and love for all of you guys, okay? Are you still there, Tony?
I am still here, Luca.
Good. Lisa, last thing I want to ask you, what you don't have to answer, of course, what exactly brought you from leaving Connecticut? You were a young guy when you left, almost, you know, the same time when I came to America, 17 years ago.
I was 19 years old when I left.
You were a kid. I mean, seriously, I was a little older than you. I came here when I was 30 and I left Italy. You left Connecticut to come to Arizona. What brought you here? To Arizona?
My parents actually brought me here.
Okay.
They left Connecticut because my father wanted to stay self-employed. Mm. And it was very hard to do at the time in Connecticut.
I see.
Because of business taxes and restrictions and regulations.
I see.
So he moved out to Arizona to remain self-employed.
All right. At least a good job. But my best to you and your family. And one day, maybe, you know what, if you ever come around Mojave County, I make a pretty decent pasta, and I'll be happy to share it with you, my friend, okay?
Thank you very much, Luca.
Very good. Thank you. Okay, guys and girls, today's show, it's over. This is the Hour About Love. And I tell you, I really like to meet people like him, because Tony, you know, for me, could be almost, if I had one day a grandson. It's kind of interesting. I'm always fascinated about these stories, you know, and of course, to understand also, you know, thinking about, you go from a state like Connecticut to Arizona, it's like almost you go from Italy to another continent, to America, seriously. Anyway, that's enough. If you want to support this show, please don't forget, I need your help. Go to www.zanna.us. You will find also the link, not just for my songs, but also for my newest production, my new ebook, Lyrics and Poems, the complete collection of all my songs, lyrics and poems, for just $2.99, available at Amazon. Thank you very much. Ciao, and God's willing, I'll talk to you next Sunday.